The following program contains mature language and potential spoilers. Listeners be advised.
Fans of the channel are going to know that I have not been a very big fan of Christopher Can't Write Well at Marvel Comics. The relationship between Tony Stark and Patsy Walker, aka Hellcat, aka fourth-rate Batwoman. And apparently, they're going to take their relationship to the next level.
This is about exactly what I'd expect from Christopher Can't Write Well.
So basically, this character, Patsy Walker, has been nagging Tony and telling him he's a piece of shit because he's white and he's rich and whatnot, and putting him in his place and stuff like that. And now Tony is going to somehow acquiesce despite being a billionaire playboy, you know, not having a problem with the ladies. He's been in a lot of relationships over the years, and he's going to put a ring on this one. The fucking hag, the nag that has been bugging him and ruining his comic book series is finally, he's going to try to tie the knot.
The Marvel superheroes have arrived. The Marvels in America's
Fantastic Four.
Spider-Man.
Iron Man.
It's 2020. I can tell you that because I was looking to read that material, and unfortunately, because it was 2020, they had to have an event miniseries called Iron Man 2020 about Arnold Stark that involved like five or six other spinoff titles and one-shots and miniseries and shit. And then it's like, well, how do I find Iron Man that was launched in the year 2020 probably out of that event? Well, it's gonna be a little bit trickier.
Are we recording?
Welcome to the Marvel Superheroes Podcast. I'm Diabolu Frank, and with me is
Illegal Machine.
And the reason why I'm talking at the beginning is because Illegal Machine's gonna be doing a lot more talking than I am, because he read a 2-year run of Iron Man comics and I read like a 5-issue miniseries and an annual. So he's got a lot more shit to say than I do. So do you want to recap the reason why this is happening?
Yeah, we can talk about this.
Hey, by the way, yeah, ain't it nice? We're talking about comic books on a Marvel Superheroes podcast?
We're gonna talk about a lot of comic books, you guys.
Change of pace.
And with Hellcat, which I know a lot of people like listening to us talk about Hellcat. It's been a while.
Do they? I like talking about it. I don't know if anybody likes listening to us.
If this is your first time listening to the podcast,
this is definitely not the first time listening to the podcast.
It could be somebody's first time listening to the podcast. I don't know.
I don't think we talked about this on this podcast, though. We talked about it. I threw it on a rolled spine B-roll.
Yeah, we did. So that's what I'm going to talk about again. Although I should probably have listened to that because I don't totally remember all the details myself of how I found this stuff. So I don't know if I was just browsing Amazon or I saw a story that Christopher...
You told me YouTube videos.
I'll get to that. Christopher Cantwell, who is a writer for Marvel Comics, his run, he started the reboot of Iron Man after, I think, Dan Slott wrapped up, right?
See, you've been out of comic books for a while.
I've been out of comic books. Okay, so let me back up and talk about that.
They don't do reboots anymore. Literally every year or two, almost every title restarts from one.
Let me set that stage first. So I'm an Iron Man fan. I'm an OG Iron Man fan from like late 80s into the 90s. I'm a Bob Layton, Dave Michelinie, first and second run guy.
You're around for John Byrne and John Romita Jr. and Paul Ryan and Lynn Kaminsky.
My boy Lynn Kaminsky.
Kevin Hopgood. Who's the one that you like the best? There's one particular artist that you like, wasn't there?
I had his name too. Morgan.
Tom Morgan?
Tom Morgan.
Okay.
Huge Tom Morgan guy.
I love Tom Morgan. He's
I would love to get some Tom
Very
Morgan.
Very underrated artist.
Original Iron Man art.
I felt like he was the modern Sal Buscema, except that his career outlived Sal Buscema. Sal Buscema's career outlived his, it seemed like, because he doesn't really do a lot anymore. So Sal was there in the beginning, and Sal is still doing stuff at the end of the comic book lifespan.
So I faded out.
You were there for Heroes Reborn.
Heroes Reborn, and then when they came back from Heroes Reborn, Kurt Busiek and Sean Chin.
A few years into that.
Yep.
Oh no, you were. Did you finally die out with Joe Quesada and Mike Grell?
No, I did. It was when Grell started. That was sort of where I was sort of like, I'm kind of done with comic books. Yeah.
It had also been like years since you enjoyed Iron Man comic books. Like you struggled through some of the Busiek stuff, as I recall.
Yeah, a little bit, but then. Yeah, the Quesada stuff got really rough, and then I ended up having
the Man in the Iron Mask.
I had a bunch of online beef with Joe Quesada and Tom Brovert.
You literally beefed with him on.
Beefed with Joe Quesada, and I even had some shots taken at me in some of those issues that I need to find and bring up one day. It's a whole thing, anyway. So then I kind of got out of comics for a long time, right? And then the movies, although you know we've been podcasting for damn near a decade now at this point, right?
9+ years now.
So we cover like Iron Man's origin. We've covered some spot fill-in issues. issue. Mr. Fix-It and I did a couple Hulk, Iron Man crossover issues.
When we did this podcast at some points on a nigh-weekly basis, but mostly monthly, and then for a while they're quarterly as my interest waned in covering Marvel materials in general. So we had more time for comic books when we had more episodes and less distractions with other projects, basically.
And life.
Yeah.
So anyway, I hadn't actually I sat down, I've been reading some of my Essential Iron Man, so I've gone back through all the Tales of Suspense stuff. Mm-hmm. We never recorded any of that, but I'd read it. With COVID, I was like, you know, I went back through my Iron Man collection. I was trying to fill in gaps where I had these tiny little gaps in my old Volume 1 Iron Man, because I, you know, at some point I'm not going to collect every Iron Man issue out there, but of the original run of Iron Man, I was filling in gaps in that. And then, you know, every now and then I'll be in a comic shop, and like whether we go out, we're looking for back issues and stuff, and I'll see something that's new in their new stuff, and it like will pique my interest. Mm-hmm. And then I'll talk to somebody about, oh yeah, you know, what's going on with Iron Man now? They'll be like, oh, he's adopted, and have you heard about Superior Iron Man?
Yeah, Karen Gillan had a nice run that people seem to like.
You hear about Cosmic Iron Man? Yeah, he's got the power Cosmic now. And I'd just be like, you know what? I'll go back and read back issues. It seems like it's too much. Or he died again. Yeah. You know, and it's just like, I don't have time for this kind of shit. So I'll go back and read my Lynn Kaminsky stuff. So anyway, the Christopher Cantwell's run always kind of popped up in my brain because of the Alex Ross covers.
Right.
The fact that you got Alex Ross, you have Iron Man getting Alex Ross cover every month. And these covers are amazing throughout the book. I don't want to get into that part yet. But so they were always there. They're like, man, you know, if I ever wanted to read something, I want to read this stuff. And then I had heard that like Hellcat was in the book and he and her had like a thing going. I'm like, oh shit, well, we read, you know, some Patsy and Hetty stuff and some Hellcat stuff for the podcast. So I would like actually kind of know some of the background for some of that. You know, so it's always piqued my interest. And they started collecting this stuff in trades, and then he finally wrapped up his run. So it was like done. And I was like, oh, okay. So if I want to actually buy these trades, I could read the entire story. I wouldn't know what precedes it, but from what I understand, this was kind of a cold opening for these books anyway. You didn't really need to know too much about what was going on prior to that. You know, he's not like half cyborg. And you're like, well, how did he become half cyborg? It wasn't that shit. That's kind of what I meant by not a reboot. So yes, it's
fresh start.
It starts with number one, but it's very much a fresh start with number one. So
is it though?
Kind of. We'll get into
it. Yeah, because I have questions.
Yeah. So, and I may not be able to answer them for God's sake. So I went ahead and I found some really good deals on eBay and used on Amazon for some of these trades, for three of the trades. And then the fourth trade that collects issues, I think it's 20 to 25 or something like that. Mm-hmm. 20 to 25. I found it at half price books and we were out. It was just randomly sitting there. I'm
and you
shit.
Only come with a certain time.
Yeah.
Like me and Fix It are much more likely to hit one of those places.
And it was
Once or twice a year, and probably wasn't even one of the good ones.
And it was a really good price. And I'm like, well, this is the fourth book to the trades. I got these other three that have just been sitting there on one of my comic boxes. So I'm like, let me buy it. And then the other day, you know, my boys were playing some video games. I didn't have anything to do. So I went and I picked them up. And I realized that, you know, modern comic books take 45 seconds to read. So by the end of the night, I'd blown through 2 years of Iron Man comics. It had been maybe 3 hours, you know. And that includes me kind of like rereading some of the stuff over again. Like, did I miss something here? And you kind of go back. You know, we space out and you realize you got a couple pages.
Right.
So next thing I know, I'd read the entire run. So to go back to what you were talking about earlier, when I had bought these, the Amazon reviews are like 5 stars. Everybody's like, this run is amazing. It's one of the best Iron Man runs. Da, 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 right. So I was like, okay, cool. You know, it's like a $10 trade.
I think you were telling me something like Return to the Classic Iron Man. Return to Greatness.
And you know, the Alex Ross armor is very much his classic armor, kind of updated.
They tweaked it a little bit, but
it's got the mouth slots back, right? Instead of the modular armor kind of
one
look.
Of the covers very subtly showed like an angle to it where there's some nose room
a little bit
without
of nose,
actually
yeah.
having an actual like Kirby nose, and I was just so impressed that Alex Ross's ability to depict that so subtly and not majorly have to alter the armor to do that. That's cool. That was a very impressive just artistic feat.
Hold on, let me pause here because I gotta find the name of the video I ended up finding on YouTube. Hold on one second.
Okay
so then while I was searching, after I'd already bought two of these trades, were already like coming to my house, right? I was doing another search to just kind of read some more reviews on it and kind of figure out where people were at. And like when I searched it, I don't know how this didn't pop up, but there was a YouTube channel and the title of this video was 2 Year Iron Man Nightmare Over, Cantwell Run Ends.
Who published this?
And this was a dude called Thinking Critical. And it's this guy's page. I think we talked about this. This guy's page is weird because he's got, he's got like 30,000 subscribers. I mean, it's not bad. He's got like 7,000 views on this video. So I mean, the dude is decent.
Well, of course, and I think my question at the time was, he's some kind of comics gator or something. something? Is he some anti-woke?
He may be. Ideologue? I have no idea. And then the next video I watched was, and I think it was a different dude, and he was as down on this as well. And then I kind of started looking for more articles on it, and I was like, holy shit. Like, maybe I got a little duped by those Amazon reviews.
Yeah.
People seem to fucking hate this run of comics, except it only kind of made me just like want to read it more.
Right.
And especially when you read a lot of it, seemed some of it kind of was, oh, you mean this is basically a Hellcat book with Iron Man guest appearing in it? And I was like, okay, well, there could be an ulterior motive there for not liking Hellcat in the book. I like Hellcat. So if she's in it and they got some, you know, I don't have a problem with that. Whereas I can see if you just joined it looking for Iron Man and you just walked out of Captain Marvel and you're all misogynist up when your new issue Iron Man pops up and you're pissed off. I'm like, yeah, okay, because I can set somebody off. So
I just question, what is the only Prince LP you own so far since you've been buying vinyl?
Oh, well, no, I've got Controversy 1990. Well,
okay, I didn't know if you'd bought any more since then. Controversy is what I was looking for.
Controversy. I have 1999 Controversy and
Purple Rain. Yeah. I think I remember you getting Purple Rain out of
that. That was the first one.
Yeah. I thought Controversy was first.
No, I could. I wanted to get Controversy. I couldn't find a good copy at a decent price. Whereas, and then 1999s are everywhere. I found it. I think I got it for like $12.
Yeah.
Anyway, back to Iron Man. So anyway, I was more lathered up than ever to read this book because it was like, man, people fucking hate this shit. And so it seems to me like either way, I'm going to get a reaction. Either the reaction is going to be, this is actually good and these lamos don't like it, or I'm going to read it and fucking hate the shit out of it too.
This isn't the Dark World.
Yeah. This isn't going to be a middle of the road deal. And then this dude's video, he keeps calling him Can't Write Well. Instead of Can't Well, it's Can't Write Well. He keeps calling him over. Yeah. Dude was extremely pissed off. And all of his comments, unanimous. Fucking get this guy over. But I will also say, in this guy's defense, he hated the Dan Slott run before it, and whoever wrote it, Bendis wrote it before that. He was like, the Bendis run is horrible, Dan Slott's run's horrible, this is worse than those two. So it's not like he was like, oh, I really love the Dan Slott stuff, I sure hate this because there's a girl in it. This dude's pretty much like been down on Iron Man for a while, and he's obviously an
Iron Man can relate to because you spent years hating Iron Man comics too. Yeah.
And you can relate to because you've spent years hating characters' runs.
Wonder Woman would be the one I'd grab immediately. Martian Manhunter is also a very good example of someone who I love who appears in a lot of comic books I don't love.
Yeah. I cracked into him, started reading him. You looked over him too. Is there anything you want to talk about before we kind of get? I don't want to recap the whole story.
I think we should give an overview because I don't think everybody, especially given the sales of comic books these days, being like teens, you know, of thousands, there are probably people who have no idea of what happens in this arc. My first question to you:
sure,
cracked open the first issue, Iron Man 2020 series, written by Christopher Cantwell, drawn by Kafu. Kafu, I was familiar with because I think Kafu's a him, but I don't want to say for sure because it's not exactly a precise name to help me with that. So I'm going to go with them pronouns here. They drew a Vixen miniseries that I read.
Okay.
And it was okay. It was all right. It was nice enough art. It certainly better art than I would necessarily expect from a Vixen book since they don't tend to put their greatest resources in that direction. But also kind of stiff and kind of earthy, you know, kind of a little bit of a pastel or earth tones, like a washout earth tones kind of thing.
You're talking Kafu right now.
Yeah. And so not the person I would immediately think of as being somebody to do an Iron Man comic. But since most of that first issue seems to be people in plain clothes having conversations, it seemed like a pretty good fit at that point in time. But also while looking at that, I'm thinking this is kind of a Mike Grell thing where maybe this isn't the person you want to draw an Iron Man comic book and maybe not the kind of situations you necessarily want from your Iron Man comic. But the thing that really got me is Iron Man, Tony Stark, I should say, seemed to be very downtrodden, seemed like somebody who was carrying an overabundance of guilt and some self-defeating stuff going on there, some self-flagellation seeming to happen, looking a bit more disheveled, not having the cool, precise laser cut that of a Robert Downey Jr. And so did you ever get the backstory for where he was, why he was at that
they
place?
Allude to it a couple times. I think that it was I listened to some Cantwell interviews, which we can get into because I was looking for some,
and by the way, I looked into this fellow a little bit myself. Not the Nazi. This is not the Nazi.
That is
Nazi
true.
Cantwell. This is a writer guy.
If you Google Chris Cantwell
and he's bald, you got the wrong one.
If you Google Chris Cantwell, you get a full on fucking American Nazi. Okay. Yeah. And then there's the Marvel Comics writer or
asterisk writer.
Yeah. Different guy. Right. And don't click those links, folks. It's going to fuck your algorithm all up. So it may have been from that where they talked about some of the backstory, but I guess some of the Iron Man 2020 stuff, it was all like very tech, these Uber armors, all sorts of crazy shit.
Was that like still Dan Slott? I think that was the wrap up of Dan Slott's run?
Maybe. Okay. But again, I didn't read that stuff. So
Dan Slott's another guy too that people either really love or really have serious problems with.
This book starts with
Tony's... He also gets a lot of beef on the Twitters as a voice
really.
Yes.
So this book is about getting back to basics, quote unquote. It's kind of a cliche, but mm-hmm. I think they use it even on the back of this. Yeah. Tony Stark is looking to restart his engine. He's going back to basics. They use multiple cliches there.
Well, and also I see there's an ad for the Doctor Doom solo series that ran for a little while.
Which Cantwell did.
And there was a period there when Doctor Doom was Iron Man. And I don't know when that happened exactly. I know it was in quote unquote recent years, speaking as a person who's not very good at keeping track of time anymore. So was that Doctor Doom stuff? That was after, like, you had Superior Iron Man in the early days of our podcasting, 2014 or so.
And I've tried to find that stuff, but the trades, at least when I looked, the trades were extremely expensive.
Which,
and the individual
which maybe
issues,
says something, too.
The individual issues were way out of, like, there's no way I'm finding this stuff.
And then I believe after
priced.
The Superior Iron Man period, then you had the Superior Doctor Doom or Doctor Doom as Superior Iron Man or something like that. And the Doctor Doom is an element in this run as well. So I just
Cantwell wrote that Doctor Doom series.
Right, okay.
Right before, he may have been ending his Doctor Doom series when he got Iron Man.
Okay.
So that also explains why Doctor Doom pops up, because that was like, he was the last person to write Doctor Doom.
Gotcha.
The whole premise of this book is, whatever happened in the prior couple runs was like extremely big, extremely ridiculous, and Tony's looking to get back to his roots.
Bust some bank robbers.
Right. So he moves back to New York, he gets a brownstone apartment, he downgrades his armor. He goes back to the classic style armor. It's a little hopped up, but not what he'd been using in the past. Yeah. And he's fighting guys like Unicorn.
He's flying coach. He's trying to invest in endeavors that are optimistic.
He takes all of his money out of Stark.
Public, that kind of thing.
All of his Stark money he takes out. And he's it's kind of like a little bit like the MCU Iron Man, where he says, we're not building bombs anymore. We're not. Yeah. It's kind of one of those deals without being exactly the same. So that's kind of where he's at. So yeah, he's got a lot. He's,
so Tony got woke.
You're right. He's insecure, Tony Stark, but now he's also being faced with the realities of being a very... You see something troubling on that?
No,
the realities of being a formerly or always rich my whole life guy who is now trying to not be rich by moving to Brooklyn and trying to get in roots with in contact with the city. And he's finding out that, like, he's just been a rich boy his whole life and he doesn't know how to do that. Mm-hmm. And throughout the course of the first issue, he runs into Patsy Walker, aka Hellcat.
Well, specifically, he's at a party that's being thrown by investors, and everybody's trying to talk him into investing in stuff. And for some reason, he detonates an EMP.
Yeah.
What was the rationale?
To fry all their phones. Because she's all like, I thought you were getting out of all this stuff. Why are you having a big party with all these guys? And he's like, because I set an EMP bomb to go off in about 5 minutes to kill all their phones.
So he's just trolling the rich.
He's like trolling rich people, even though he's a rich guy.
Right.
Right.
Also, what's Patsy Walker doing at this party then?
I can't remember exactly. It doesn't matter.
I don't think they explain it. I read through the issue, and I don't think they explain what she's doing at the party, and I'm more concerned about why she's there than why Tony's there.
Yeah, I'm not sure it's ever really explained.
Yeah.
Maybe it is. It doesn't matter.
I do think it's cute, though, that she's wearing a dress that is definitely influenced by her superhero costume.
Totally.
Just to let people know who this person is.
Yeah. And so to go back to Kafu.
Yes. My pronunciation, I do not know if that's correct.
Yeah, I don't know either. I think they say Kafu in the podcast I was listening to. They might have said Kafu, and I don't think anybody corrected anybody.
Yeah.
So, we'll talk about art later. Mm-hmm. Let's not talk about art.
Sure.
We'll talk about it. We already talked about Alex Ross.
Not the only artist on this run anyway.
Yeah, because Kafu can't do a monthly series, I'm guessing, for too long. Although, you know what? This is over 2 years.
He gets a lot of issues in.
A guy gets a break every now and then. Although, I think the whole last trade he doesn't do anything in. I don't know how long their run was supposed to be. So, anyway. So, that's the basic premise of where Tony's at as the story starts. And kind of throughout the entire run is this Tony's insecure. Kind of everything always goes wrong, even with Tony's best intentions. Whether it's Tony or Iron Man. It doesn't matter if let's say he saves the world. Well, okay, he saves the world, but all this other stuff gets fucked up.
Right.
And he's kind of focusing on, well, even when I win, I lose, right? I fucked all this other stuff up. And that's kind of how it goes in this book. Everything he tries to do right, he kind of messes up. And Hellcat's there is somebody who is kind of the opposite. She's had like the worst life of any character in Marvel history, right?
Yeah.
Between, you know, dying and being enslaved in hell and marrying the son of Satan and having, you know,
well, they definitely make a point of underlying death by suicide. I killed myself. Why did I kill myself? Oh, well, let me tell you about my mother.
Yeah.
Let me tell you about my home life. You know, it's like all this horrible stuff.
So she's coming how she's dealt with all of these, like, what I think she kind of sees as like were real problems, whereas his problems aren't real problems. He's got rich boy problems.
Yeah.
So she's kind of there to kind of bring
I have to say, in case I forget, very big Green Lantern, Green Arrow energy in this book. Like, it's one of those things where back in the 70s, they put those two characters together because Danny O'Neill O'Neill couldn't write cosmic stuff or didn't want to. He wanted to write social issue stuff. So they bring Green Arrow into the book and they turn him into an ultra-mouthy liberal who's constantly criticizing everything that Green Lantern does and pointing out what that he's a fascist space cop and all this kind of stuff. And then they're hard-traveling heroes, so they're traveling around the country to show Green Lantern that he's lost touch with his, you know, earthling ways and have him face real-world problems and constantly be antagonized by Green Arrow, this person who's supposed to be his buddy. Very similar energy in this book, it seems like. Like, the premise, forcing these two characters together that don't really have a lot to do with one another, yeah, they served on the same team on occasion, but not really. Like she was an Avenger for five and a half minutes, right?
Yeah.
So it's very forced, but and the dynamic is very similar to that, where Tony just can't get anything right, and Hellcat's going to point that out to him for the whole run.
Okay, so I'm not a Green Arrow, Green Lantern guy, so that's excellent context there, sir. Yes, that's kind of what it's like. She's there to kind of keep him in check. They go to like yoga together and stuff. There's like a little bit of a relationship forming, which I think works pretty well, because she is giving him a hard time, but it's almost, you know, sometimes that's kind of a way of flirting too.
Yeah,
where you're kind of rudest and kind of dig at somebody, but it's really because you have feelings for him.
The adult equivalent of tugging on the pigtails of the girl in front of you because you like her.
Exactly. Yeah. And so that's how I looked at it. So I could see how if you didn't look at it that way, you would maybe get a little more offended. Like, what the fuck is this book about? Like,
right.
This book is they're just shitting on this guy. And as soon as he shits on himself, she pops into a panel and then shits on him some more. And it's like, oh, this is how many? We got a couple of years of this, right? But you know, the first, especially the first five issue, the first trade. It's really, you know, there's some, look, no, this is where I have to take a step back. But there were some choices made in this first issue this first book I don't understand. So part of what Tony's doing is, you know, he buys a brownstone in New York and then he decides he wants to buy a muscle car. So as he's fighting Terrax in the opening pages and he's talking in his head about different cars he may want. 71 Duster would be fucking badass. Mm-hmm. You definitely want to get 71 Duster. And then he settles on a 78, like, Dodge Aspen. This is not a muscle car. Mm-hmm. I don't know why, like, I think even in the room he's in. Hold on. I'm flipping. Give me one second. 1978 Dodge Aspen. He's like, stock. Back to the basics, right? So he's driving around New York in a Dodge Aspen. So, but what I don't understand is a Dodge Aspen's a piece of shit. Like, I don't understand the car choice.
You're a car guy, right? And obviously there are times when you're like, oh, these dumbasses, they're buying these shitty cars because they're too stupid to know they're shitty car. But they still buy those cars. I think Wildcat's one of the ones that you point to is like not a great choice for a car.
A Wildcat?
Is that the one? What's it called? Hellcat?
A Hellcat.
Okay.
I had a Hellcat.
Okay. So what is the cars like you think are shitty cars that other people like and buy?
I don't know.
Okay. Well, point is this a situation where you are just stating your opinion the broad opinion of anybody who knows cars?
Because it looks like a very, it's such a peculiar choice.
Mm-hmm.
A 1978 Dodge Aspen, it is a bizarre car. If I showed a picture of a 1978 Dodge Aspen to 100 people, zero people would say that's a 1978 Dodge Aspen.
I'm not sure if I've ever heard of that car.
You may not have, but it's such a specific choice. Like, I think Cantwell left X, but I literally opened up my phone to try and find him on Twitter to see if I could ask him, like, bro, I don't give a shit about any of this run. Why did you pick a 1978 Dodge Aspen? Like, I just don't. The muscle car era died in 1970. Mm-hmm. Okay, you had a couple cars went into 1971, 1972 that were still fast. By 1978, the oil crisis was in full swing. Cars, they were putting out V8s with like 100 horsepower. Like, there is nothing attractive coming out, and there's nothing fast coming out in 1978 for you to be having you don't go through a midlife crisis and get a 1978 Dodge Aspen. You don't. In 1978, you're driving a Dodge Aspen because you were poor.
You think maybe it was like him trying to do the whole common man thing and like leaning into that?
But it's like black.
Or is it like that he's been so rich for so long that anything that's not a Bentley, he can't tell the difference?
No, because before that, he's driving an AC Cobra or a Ford Cobra, and he like kind of almost wrecks it. But
I have heard of those cars and I'm aware that they are desirable.
Well, they made a movie with Sylvester Stallone called Cobra, where he drove one. But it's just like, he's like, oh, you know, I just want something simple. There's nothing more simple than a fucking Ford Cobra. Like, it's a metal shell with an engine in it. Like, there's nothing. So then he gets this Dodge Aspen, but it's like black with like racing stripes down the side of it. So then I'm like, does Cantwell think that like a Dodge Aspen is like, did he like try and Google 70s cars and just like found it and thought it looked cool and told him he got a 78 Dodge Aspen? Or is he trolling Tony? Like, does Tony not, Tony's so dumb.
So out of it.
He just saw this car and was like, ooh, that's what I want. But if anybody who actually knows cars reads this, they know that he picked like one of the lamest fucking car. He probably picked the lamest car at this dealership, which, by the way, I don't know why a 1978 Dodge Aston would be at any dealership.
Right.
Because it's got zero collectible value. So why is it at this dealership? This was the second or third page of the book.
Right.
And it haunted me.
I have to say that this is not the only time stuff like that's going to come up in my skim of the book.
Okay. So, but that also leads me to my next point. He gets into underground street racing.
In the Neon, or what is it called?
A 1978
Aspen.
Dodge Aspen.
Aspen, okay. Yeah. Neon sounds better. That sounds like a car you could compete with.
If you got a
Aspen,
Neon, I would get it. It's like urban camouflage. Right. Nobody would know Tony Stark driving in it. Driving a completely mint 1978 Dodge Aspen is so peculiar.
Right.
You might as well be in a Lambo. Right. Like, I would be freaking out. Like, how did you get a completely restored 78 Dodge
Aspen?
You'd
be craning your neck just because you've never seen that car on the road before.
I saw one at a car show, and it was absurdly restored. Mm-hmm. Driven by the weirdest dude. The only type of guy.
He definitely busted his cherry in one of those.
That would brag about his 1978 Dodge Aspen.
Right.
With gold interior. Like, it was ridiculous. So anyway, that's where I was like, okay, well, maybe he doesn't want
something.
I'm
just trying to figure out if my father bought a Dodge Aspen.
He might have. So that's, at first I was like, that's a weird specific choice, a Dodge Aspen. Folks, we're going to talk about this car a lot. But then I was like, okay, is Cantwell trolling Tony?
Right.
Like, Tony's so dumb. He's such a rich guy. He doesn't even understand. He just bought a piece of stupid
shit. He might as well bought
a
Goblin.
He got screwed by this guy.
Yeah.
This guy was like, oh, slapping the hood. This baby right here has got 150 horsepower, pure. You want simple, this is it, right? So then I was like, or is he just trying to get so back to basics? He wanted urban camouflage, what a Neon would be.
Yeah.
He's buying a Dodge Aspen because it's lame, right? Until the next page when he goes street racing in it. And then I'm like, something is not.
Right.
Nobody in 78 street raced a Dodge Aspen. Yeah. Like, that's not what they do. You would go buy a Dodge Charger out of a junkyard and race it. Like, why the fuck are you racing? Just very bizarre to me. He should have been driving a Chevelle or a Mustang or a Charger or something. It's just, I couldn't get over it. So then, of course, he goes to an underground street race with $5,000 and wants to race to do $5,000, gets smoked by this dude in an El Camino. Gets just
As
you do in a Dodge Aspen. I mean, you are living the vintage lifestyle, showing up like a dork in a Dodge Aspen and getting the doors blown off of you by an El Camino. And the dude looks like Toretto from the Fast Furious movies. Turns out he's deaf. He comes back later on.
Is that that guy? Okay.
That's that guy.
Okay.
That's that guy.
I was trying to figure out. I thought that he was maybe some obscuro character they plucked out from an X title or something.
No, but Dom Toretto.
Yeah.
So he smokes him in the stuff. So then I'm just like, why would he go to a street? Like, does somebody who puts street racing?
How would he know where to even go? He Googled that too, I guess.
Does somebody who street races in a comic book, like the writer, does he put street racing in the comic book because he knows, like, he likes cars and wants to race? Because picking the Dodge Aspen tells me you don't.
Yeah.
But picking the Dodge Aspen tells me you do because it's so obscure. So I'm doing the Princess Bride, where I'm at the table, where I'm like, you put the poison in my drink because you think that I'm going to pick your drink. But then I was doing this whole fucking first trade. I couldn't get over this Dodge Aspen. And why the fuck did Tony pick a Dodge Aspen? And why did he street race a Dodge Aspen?
Right.
Like, he's still Tony Stark. He could pick up his cell phone and just fucking Google this shit. Like, I don't understand it. It drives me insane. The melter breaks his car.
Yeah.
Melts it. It's gone. The Dodge Aspen does not make it more than a couple issues in this book, so it doesn't really matter. Except it's driving me fucking insane.
Throughout the 2-year run, you never get a resolution of the Dodge Aspen.
No, I never figure out why the fuck you picked the Dodge Aspen. And although by the time I'm done reading the 2 years worth of books, I kind of start to lean to one of the things I mentioned. So that's where Tony's at. He's buying Dodge Aspens. He's losing street races. He's having a general shitty time. At that party, there's sort of a Iron Man 3 moment. He's bumped into by a guy who has this new technology.
He can harness lightning.
Or
he thinks he can harness lightning with the seed money that he's going to get from Tony Stark.
So Tony ends up calling him, giving him the seed money because he's like, you know, that's like true renewable energy.
He still gets his phone destroyed by the EMP though.
Probably.
Yeah. So it's almost more of an Iron Man 3 moment.
I said Iron Man 3.
Did you? Okay.
Because that was how
Guy Pierce's character.
What was his name? Killian.
We don't care. It's Iron Man 3. Nobody cares.
So anyway, you kind of go on. So that's where you had mentioned a little bit earlier. He was doing stuff like flying coach, right?
Yeah.
And he gets in the plane.
And of course, he's bitching about flying coach.
And because he tries to like lean his seat back.
And she's like, no, you can't do that.
Patsy's like, you can't do that because the flight hasn't taken off. You have to wait for the ding. And he's all like, I've never heard of that rule before. And she's like, that's because you've never flown on something that wasn't a private plane.
Right.
And he's all
they're
like,
they're not going to bring you a wine flute.
Right. Wah, wah. And that's where I'm like, ooh, yeah. Like if I was reading this book and I've suffered through.
What gets me is at the end of that conversation, she then proceeds to recline, which A, I don't think that they've taken off by that point. B, she's also reclining in daylight hours. It's like, so she's the bitch in the situation. Trust me, I've spent too much time on planes with motherfuckers who want to recline immediately. You're the asshole. In case you didn't know, you're the asshole.
So here's the
and trust me, there are times I want to recline. And in fact, we try to get seats where we can recline because there's nobody behind us whenever we can. But if I can't, I almost never recline because I'm not a dick.
So here's their conversation on the airplane.
Well, I'm not a dick in those circumstances.
I'm like, is this really all the leg room? This is Tony. Is this really all the leg room there is back here? And Patsy says, yeah. They also don't bring around flutes of champagne after takeoff. Tony, I can't believe that I had to pay $50 to check a bag. It's coach, Tony. And what were we? Boarding group 165? You seem ill at ease. And he's like, nothing coffee and powdered creamer won't fix.
Why would $50 matter to Tony Stark? It's like pocket change.
So then
bitch, because I have to pay 50 cents to get into a bathroom stall and some places, you know? So then, the only problem is if I have coins on
it. So then they have a zoom in of him hitting the recline button. He's like, you can't recline until the captain says. I've never heard that rule. She says, because you don't own this jet. Why are you even flying all the way back here anyway? And he's like, I feel like I don't understand something. I don't know actual life. And coach will solve it? Ease off, will ya? So it's like, these are the conversations he and Patsy are having for basically
the entire two years.
There's another scene, right, where he's flying. I picked some scenes out of the first trade to kind of set the vibe of the whole trade, where he flies to a school in New York, okay? And I don't know if you probably skimmed right past this page, but he flies down while they're at recess. He's like, hey, kids, and they're like, it's Iron Man! And they're running up, and they're talking about how shiny he is. And then two of the teachers who are working recess come out, and they're like, okay, everybody, that's the recess bell. Oh, man. They're like, but Iron Man's here. And he's like, Iron Man goes, can you give me 5 more minutes? And they're like, it's going to take them the rest of the day to calm down. And I apologize, but all visitors are really supposed to sign into the front desk. And he's like, I just thought it would be fun. They're like, for them or for you? He's like, excuse me? Our days are carefully built around structured fun centered on learning. And he's like, okay, I get it. You two seem like real fun. Here I was just in the neighborhood. That's all. We'd love to have you back for a specific activity, but drop-ins like this can be very disruptive. And then he flies off. That's the scene.
Yeah.
Okay. So then, and anyway, the next scene is literally he shows up at his garage and somebody spray painted Eat the Rich on his garage and he opens
that
it up.
Yeah, that I saw. I remember that.
And the melter has melted his Dodge Aspen. And he just says, the melter, seriously, we're doing this now? And he says, I melted your car. And he says, I can see that. Then he says, are you mad? And then he just punches him in the face and just like his whole face like explodes in blood. That's what precedes them getting on that coach flight to fly back. So like they're really like.
Well, and at one point she does say, you nearly killed a guy for melting your car.
Was that for keeping the car or was that cardiac? Yeah, that was melter. Yeah, so he beats him up, flies really high up, folks. Really high up. And then just lets him go. And for a second, you can still see he's like contemplating to just letting him fall to his death. And then he swoops in and saves him at the last second. Mm-hmm. And that's when he gets on. It's just like, so Tony's in a bad place. Yeah. Right? Like if you couldn't tell, he almost killed the guy. So that's right before their conversation on the plane. So they're flying out to check out.
It would have been worth him melting the car if I'd have caught him.
If I'd caught him doing it. So they're flying to the pilot project for this lightning project that he seeded this guy. He angel invested this guy. He built this field. Shows up. Gets hit by lightning. Turns out this dude is actually Korvac. We all know Korvac, ladies and gentlemen. He's killed the Avengers.
There's a good chance they don't know Korvac, even though it is, from my understanding, I don't think I've ever read it. I just know about it. I've read like Avengers Saga or some stuff where they talk about stuff like that. You've talked to me about it many a times over the years.
Roger Stern, George Perez.
Jim Shooter wrote some of that too, though, didn't he?
Jim Shooter too.
Yeah.
It's a really famous Korvac Saga. He became the most powerful. So he was a dude. He got tortured by some aliens. They chopped him up. They basically put him on a big floating platform, cut his like part of his face. He might have had a fake eye.
Yeah, it was weird
arm.
Because his upper body is human, but then he's got this square thing, and then there's this like jet thing underneath, and he just sort of floats around like a old reverse chess piece or something.
Yeah, so
it's like he's riding an upside down pawn.
Extremely powerful, and then
God class, you know,
because he steals the power of Galactus and gets this ridiculous amount of power, kills the Avengers. Yada, yada, yada. It's a whole bunch of stuff. Folks, go read the Korvac Saga. It's some of the more legendary Avengers reading over the last, whatever,
wasn't there a thing,
years.
Too? I think Mark Waid had, like, Captain America fight Korvac, and everybody was like, nah, dog, nah.
Was that Korvac?
Or was it Kazar? Kazar was Thanos. I know Kazar and Thanos, because everybody was like, Mr. Mark Waid, you don't know your Marvel
character
that well.
After Korvac died, he never came back.
From the 70s?
After the Korvac Saga.
Oh, no, he definitely did. And I want to say he fought Captain America during the Mark Waid Kubert run.
Korvac?
Yeah.
Google it on your phone.
Nah. I don't know. Don't worry about it. It's not that that big of a deal. My understanding is that there was a situation where this was a very well-regarded Avengers arc, and that character was left alone for a long time.
He was left alone for a long time.
And then somebody brought him back in a way that people were like, you brought him back for this? Really?
Now you mention that, kind of sounds familiar. But anyway, he'd been done for a long time. Even if they brought him back in the Mark Waid stuff, that's still 20 plus years when he was probably gone, right?
You're right.
So anyway, although they don't talk about any of that shit, but maybe for
They showed the origin. I remember them showing them chopping him up and stuff.
But they don't show anything in between there.
Oh yeah, definitely no 90s revival of him stuff.
So there was a book by, let's see, hold on, should have brought my notes up here. Although I didn't take notes on the actual comics. So Al Ewing did like a one shot or like a one page story, and I think it was called Marvel Comics 1000 or something like that. There was some.
Okay, yeah, there was that one shot that came out. Yeah,
they did a story where Korvac was discovered by some alien race, and they turn him into this android, and that's what comes off here. So it turns out that this guy who had asked Tony for
the seed money
was Korvac in this android body that was set up in this issue by Al Ewing, right?
And also he has electrical powers now,
right? But he needs to power up in steps, mm-hmm. right? So the first step was to get the money from Tony to build this electrical farm
and one thing we haven't really touched upon, because you did briefly mention Cardiac, and of course you mentioned the Melter. There's a bunch of Silver Bronze Age characters that will be familiar from
Controller, Blizzard, Unicorn, Cardiac, Melter,
and of course Cardiac was a vigilante character, an anti-hero in the Spider-Man comic books. So him being like doing stuff, well, I know there's a little subplot where, because he's a medical vigilante, there were people who were like, oh, the capitalist superhero has to beat up on the guy who's trying to stop, you know, corporate medicine that, you know, with income inequality that prevents people from getting healthcare and yada 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 yada. But the big problem is that all these guys are talking like crazed evangelists. They've all become religious zealots in worshiping a new godlike being who turns out to be Michael Korvac.
Well, okay, well,
so it all,
you know, actually
together.
I don't know if Cardiac was tied into Korvac.
Was he separate?
No, I think he was separate. It does get a little blurry because some of these guys,
I literally didn't read it.
I think Cardiac was going off that he captured all those Stark scientists. He said your scientists want to develop high cost cures and let them feel the effects of untreated disease at the moment of death. Like, that's all he does is rant in these panels about how Tony Stark has bumped up the cost of healthcare. If you haven't caught on to maybe Chris Cantwell's politics, you can start. But again, this is issue 2. So like all the other stuff I've talked about, we're kind of dragging Tony down. On top of that, Cardiac is showing up trying to kill a bunch of Tony's scientists because Tony Stark is also the reason why the healthcare industry is full of shit and is overpriced and people are gonna, like, a message has to be sent. Your employees have to die. Our healthcare system is a crime. Like, that's literally, that was Cardiac's line from the book, right?
Right.
So he's gonna kill a bunch of these scientists. So yeah, shows up at the electrical farm, gets ambushed by the controller.
I think it bears mentioning too.
Wait, go for it.
It isn't that Iron Man gets ambushed. It's Iron Man and Hellcat, because from the first issue on, she becomes his de facto sidekick.
Yeah.
And it's one thing when you've got like Daredevil and Black Widow teaming up for a bunch of adventures together. But again, very much like Green Lantern, Green Arrow, there's a huge power imbalance here. You know, it's like he's flying with his jet boots and she's like hanging on to
him. She's in a Jeep Wrangler.
Right.
In this scene, she's driving a Jeep Wrangler.
Yeah, she saves him by running down some people in her Jeep.
In a Jeep, yeah. Anyway, so he gets ambushed. That's where it turns out the dude's Korvac, okay? Like, you know.
Well, they do that thing too where she gets zapped and she has those scars on her half her face for like the entire fucking run.
Yeah.
But then that goes away almost immediately.
They
afterwards.
Go away.
Like, what was that about? Did they ever like explain why they felt the need to have her be scarred for a long period of time?
No, I didn't get it.
Is this some sort of meta text where like she's scarred on the inside, so we're showing her on the outside?
I don't know, because they kind of forget about it.
Yeah,
it's a thing for the rest of this issue because she's like even crabbier.
The rest of the trade, I think, at least it's number of issues. Yeah, I kept waiting for it to go away.
I mean, this is like the last issue-ish of this trade.
Because I should point out that because of my interest in the Hellcat character, I bought the Iron Man Hellcat Annual that preceded a Hellcat solo miniseries in which she does not have facial scars. So I know that they're going to go away the entire time I'm going through these issues, and I'm wondering why they're there and when they'll be gone.
Yeah, it's like it's fractal burn from the electricity. But when she gets hit, she also gets like this psychic link to Korvac. So all of these guys, like you mentioned earlier, they're all worshiping him like he's God now. So Unicorn is spouting all this stuff like, he is risen and he is done. Like, he's like a maniac, and they're all completely brainwashed by dude. And a part of it is, I think, because he's in their heads. Mm-hmm. And when she got got zapped by his lightning powers. Now he's kind of in her head, and she can like hear him whispering to her and stuff like that.
Well, and was this before or after they mentioned that she herself has some schizophrenic issues where she's already hearing whispers in her head?
She talks.
And now there's additional whispers?
She talks about why it's such a big deal that she's hearing voices again. Right. It's because she went through this once.
But they also had the weird thing where they, like, I think they literally say that she had schizophrenia, but it like goes away, and I don't think that's how schizophrenia works.
It may not be, but
maybe you could take pills for that or something, but I don't think it just goes away or comes and goes.
I don't know. She's still
like, you can develop it.
She still has some issues in these comics. Oh, so yeah. You can definitely say it did not go away.
Okay.
But anyway, I'm just saying her now getting this link to Korvac, but still being with Tony ends up being a thing. Because then he's kind of always knows where Tony is. He's even like talks to Tony through her a couple times, and it also causes her to start kind of falling apart.
Yeah. Well, and at one point she juices up with lightning and attacks or something too, as I recall.
I think she shocks herself to knock herself out because he's like trying to talk through her and stuff. Tony needs to build a team because they because of her link with Korvac, she now knows what he's going to do too, and he's going to go take Galactus' cosmic power.
Over the arc, she starts turning it against Korvac and being able to spy on him through this link that has been created.
Yeah, so she knows they're going to Tatu, which is Galactus' ship. He's going to sneak in, steal the power cosmic, kill everybody again. He's not a good dude.
Well, I think the original plan was he's going to merge everybody into one solid like force, and like they were going to be crystalline like beings that wanted around and eat other crystalline objects, but they're all going to be one passive existence without any independent thought or anything.
Perfect to read, like no violence, everything's going to just be perfect. And
just everybody's going to be crystal goats eating crystal grass on a crystal field.
So they're all going to drink the Kool-Aid and go in the spaceship and fly off, and everything's going to be great. So now that she can see he's going to Tatu.
By the way, as somebody who read the original 70s run, is that consistent with the Korvac character?
You know, that was something that when I was reading this, I was trying to think again, like what was his original motivation? I thought his original motivation was he just wanted to have a regular ass life on Earth, but I could be wrong. That you remember the big parts, like when he kills all the Avengers,
or because in, like, of a ridiculous
battle
budget cuts and created by Henry Peter Gyrick, they have to like take a bus to this suburban house to confront him.
Happens, right? Yeah. But when he kills them all and Perez draws it and their fucking bodies are strewn everywhere, it's just it's awesome. But you know, sometimes you lose that nugget of what was his whole motivation to begin with.
That was really cool what he did, but why did he do that?
Why
again
was he doing that anyway? Tony knows
what I love about Thanos. You're never going to forget the man fell in love with literal death and just wanted to kill as many people as possible to please his lover. So that's a great motivation. Too bad they didn't have that in the movies.
So in the first trade, they realize if he's going to Tatoo, he and his cronies are going to have to get on a spaceship and fly out to Galactus' ship, right? So the plan is we got to find, this is also this whole thing where Hellcat keeps going, why don't you just tell the Avengers, and he's like, I don't want to get the Avengers involved. You know, we don't want people to get hurt. I need to deal with this, blah, blah, blah. But then she keeps talking about how, no, you're just trying to fix all this by yourself. You created this problem because his money was
Some point he captures Rhodey
Just chill out, sir. The whole point was that she's saying the reason you don't want to tell the Avengers is because you're going to have to tell them you're the one that gave him the money to build the electrical farm that gave him the initial powers to begin with. And this is really kind of all your fault, just like everything else is your fault. So instead of going and get your buddies to fix this, you're going to try and fix it on your own, right? Like more kind of shitting on him. So he decides he needs to put together like a low-key team.
Low-key team.
So he gets Scarlet Spider, Ben Reilly. He gets the Gargoyle. He gets Frogman, Misty Knight. And then he goes back to the deaf street racer guy who turns out to have a mutant power.
His pulse never goes above 70, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, he's able to like keep it cool or whatever. Yeah.
But also he went to the guy to help him put together the team. And then he decides, oh wait, no, I want you on the team after he gets attacked.
Something like that.
Yeah.
He's got this band of like misfits, right? They
I do have to point out the parallel though, because you've got Michael Korvac and a whole bunch of guys that just barely missed the scourge of the underworld back in the 80s. And then here's Tony with the misfit band of low, you know, although there's several people like Gargoyle was from the Defenders, so it makes sense that Patsy would know him because they were teammates for a while there. Did Hellcat have anything to do with the Latter-day Defenders that Misty Knight was a part of, where she like refilled the Heroes for Hire and then I think they became Defenders?
I don't know.
But that's like not Frogman seems to be a reach though.
The OG Defenders stuff she was in gets referenced in this book. They don't reference what I believe is any newer Defender stuff. Anyway, the plan is she's gonna Iron Man's gonna tango with Korvac and distract while this team, they end up giving it some like I can't remember what they dubbed this team. It's like a silly name. It's supposed to be funny.
The Revengers.
Yeah, like we're the Revengers. Yeah, it's something like that. Or Space Friends or something like that. It's something ridiculous. They're gonna go destroy the dude's ship. Well, it turns out it's a booby trap. They get in the ship, Korvac gets a detonator and blows the ship up with all these people in it. Tony thinks they're all fucking dead. And for a second, I thought because they picked all these weird obscure characters, mm-hmm. they were actually all fucking dead. Spoiler alert, they weren't fucking dead. Gargoyle saved them all. But it's a pretty kick-ass hangover when,
cliffhanger.
That's cliffhanger, because that ends the first trade, where I'm like, holy shit, he just blew up the whole fucking thing.
And how many issues did that first trade collect?
I think this is just 1, 2, 5.
Okay. Yeah, see, one thing that's happened, how much did that cost at retail?
This was retail, $16.
Yeah. See, that's one thing that's happened in recent years, is obviously the price of the floppies has gone up and up. Standard cost for a floppy these days is about $4, but there are floppies that are in the $5 range now. I don't know what differentiates them. I think that they have backup features or they have lower circulation, so you have to pay an extra dollar for a premium. So, of course, that also means that the trade paperbacks have gone up in price, or would go up in price, but they've done some shrinkflation. So, beginning in the 2000s, pretty much every trade collected 6 issues, so every story arc ran about 6 issues, but since they've been shrinking the trade sizes, now the arcs tend to run between 4 and 5 issues, because that's how long the trades run for. You get fewer pages for about the same amount of money. So you're paying like $17 for 5 issues, where you used to pay that for 6 issues, as a for instance. And that was a few years ago. This was, I assume these trades are pre-COVID, or COVID, no, it'd have to be within COVID, because it's 2020. So these are COVID era trades, but probably over the time period, as you had things like paper shortages and printing shortages, maybe the prices go up. What are the prices going forward?
Next trade, $17.99. So right. It's already up. Trade after that, $29.99. But it is more, it's 7 issues. So this is 12 to 19.
Yeah, but it's $30 now for 7 issues, where a 6-issue trade used to be about $16.
And then the final trade is $20.
For
5 issues, 20 to 25. Yeah. They're good. They're nice quality, though.
Well, you get glossy stock and everything, you know.
Yeah.
It's hard to find things that aren't glossy stock these days. You know, it's like the default now. If anybody's going to bother to print something, they're probably going to print it on good paper, because it's not enough of a price difference anymore to get untreated pages, for instance.
So the next two trades, we don't need to go into too much detail in the next two trades. It's the journey to Tatu. Yeah, that's right. I said basically two trades to get to Galactus' ship. In the course of flying to the ship, Tony and Hellcat and Korvac are like talking on some astral plane. They're all linked in now, and Tony just vanishes. He vanishes out of the ship. He's completely gone. He gets zapped to some strange, bizarre world. It's kind of like Sakaar. It's still like a bunch of misfit characters are there. Stiltman is the one who's like the leader of this thing. There's a bunch of Ultimos. If you're an Iron Man fan, you know who Ultimo is. He's a giant doomsday machine. Apparently, this is a planet where all the Ultimos are from.
Well, at first they accused him as being a coward and running off. How did he end up there, though?
How did he get there?
Yeah.
To begin with?
I mean, I saw it. He blips out and he's gone. He tried to activate his boot jets, I think I understand. And
you're saying, how did Tony get there?
Yeah, how did Tony end up on this place?
Stiltman was actually bringing people to the planet.
Oh, specifically targeted him in that particular point in time.
He targeted Tony because, he gives in like an official reason why he actually wanted Tony there. Yeah. It's not important.
He's one of the geniuses of the Marvel Universe. That's why you want Tony there. I get that.
Yeah, I guess kind of. But it turns out that the whole thing where these Ultimos would show up and they would scare them off, and some people from the village would die, and then more people would show up. But everybody works together. Stiltman built this society himself and found out that the threat of the Ultimos would kill some of these people, and then Stiltman was the one bringing people to that planet. That like circle of fear kept everybody in control, and everybody was a tight group, and they all had there was that aura of survival.
Mm-hmm.
When it turned out at any point in time, or that all the Ultimos were actually being controlled by Stiltman.
Okay,
he was the one controlling the Ultimos, so basically he was keeping this whole mechanization.
So we have an entire Shyamalan B plot. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yeah,
they went village on this ship.
Yes,
for two trades.
Yes, and then he just blips out of it back to Korvac ship.
Yeah, because I have to point out here,
to their ship chasing Korvac.
The reason why I was talking about the changes in how trades are set up is because I'm waiting for when the 5th issue comes by and it says continued. He's like, okay, well, we're going to go to a 6-issue arc with this, right? The 6th issue comes and it's continued. Like, fuck. Okay, I know some trades will go 8 issues, so I guess this is going to continue to the 8 issue before they finish up the arc. Then I get to 8 and it's still going, and I'm just like, why is this still happening? Why are they still in space? Why isn't this resolved? Why has this all been these shitty old Bronze Age villains and Korvac on and on and on and on? And then, like you say, then he blips out and he's off doing this stuff with the Ultimos and Stiltman. I'm like, when is this going to end? I'm like, fuck, I guess it's going to be 12 issues. I get to 12 and it still continues. And ultimately, the arc runs 15 issues. Fuck! I was talking earlier about how when I ran my comic shop, we would, after the shop would close, we would get together, we'd play like Overpower or role-playing and stuff. I think in this instance, we were rating the role-play. I think part of the problem was because I was the dungeon master, the game master, whatever you want want to call it. Everybody was waiting on me to finish, but I had a customer that night. There was a manga guy, and he just wanted to go on and on and on about the fanfic manga stories that he was reading and stuff. And obviously, I have no interest, but this is one of those instances where I'm the bartender, and I'm just listening to the guy tell a story so that he can buy a bunch of manga stuff and go home, right? And then your brother, lacking a filter sometimes, this is like, you know, the shop closed at like 6, I guess, or 7. And so it's at least a half hour or more past closing time, and everybody's waiting on me to get done so I can do the DMing. And your brother just goes, "Shut up!" In a way that's like, there's no way that this person could not know that there's being talked to. He goes for maybe another 5 minutes. I cash him out. I'm like, "Please don't do that. I need to make money at this comic shop." But also, I was so sick of this conversation. I've joked about how over the years since, that went from a cringe moment where it's like, I really don't need you to tell my customers to shut up and go home, even though I kind of appreciate it. Now, and when I'm in those kind of circumstances, that voice just goes into my head. It's like, you know, and I was doing that during this run. It's like, stop doing this. Tell another story. Like, it started to become the thing that I hate about modern comics. It's like, Stanley's the one who decided, okay, we're not going to have two or three complete stories in a single comic book. We're going to actually have, not only is it going to fill, and once we're going to fill an entire comic book, but I can actually make this thing go 2, 3, and 4 issues. But when it gets to the point where it's a 15 issue arc, that decompressed storytelling is so far out of control. It was maddening to me. And I don't think that's common. I don't think this is like, this is what's wrong with the industry. You don't have 15 issue arcs typically. You might have an overarching story that encompasses multiple stories within that time period that all like terminate at a point where it's all gathering together, which is just good storytelling. But not when you're telling pretty much the same story continuously for 15 issues, where it's Iron Man in space with his ragtag buddies and shit, and his new partner and lover, Hellcat. Do find it funny that they make a point of having them have sex one time, one issue, one
right
time.
Right after her face got fucked up, too.
Right, which was nice. That's affirming. Yeah. That was affirming. Good on you, Tony. But also, they don't ever fuck again, right? Not explicitly.
No.
So, yeah.
So... Okay, so that second trade is them traveling to Korvac, or traveling to Tatu.
Well, you said that it ends with the explosion, right? Or no, the first trade ends with the explosion, the booby trap.
Yes.
So the second trade ends...
The second trade, they are traveling... So they didn't die. The ship that blew up was a dummy ship. So Korvac and his gang of apostles jump in the real ship, and they go to Tatu. Iron Man gets his dudes that did not die, but we thought they did, gets them in one of his ships, and they follow in pursuit, right? So they're flying after him. The folks I said plus Rhodey.
Well, and again, you stopped me from talking, but at some point Korvac captures Rhodey.
Yeah.
And the rationale is that he'll kill Rhodey if I get any of my high profile friends. That's why I've gotten the loser brigade. But then that's kind of fun for like a 4-issue arc or something. But these guys are with him. They're his teammates, essentially, for 15 issues. Yeah. Well, not 15 issues, because the group forms, what, like 3 issues in or so?
Yeah.
It's the 5-issue trade.
Issue four. Maybe.
Yeah. So what kills me is, like, you've already got a run that's about humiliating Iron Man or giving him humility, depending on which direction you want to look at it from. And having Iron Man hang out with guys like Frogman, sometimes that lifts up the other characters. Like, oh, this is a character. Like, if Iron Man's hanging out with Hellcat, then all of a sudden she's a little bit more of a high-profile character, and maybe she gets a little more respect because she's suddenly the lady of Tony Stark and shit. But then once you bring in all these other losers, and they're hanging out with him for an extended period of time, and then Korvac is surrounding himself with another bunch of losers, then this is a book about a bunch of losers. And it's not raising the other characters up, it's lowering Iron Man and lowering Korvac by association. It's downgrading them because of the company they're keeping.
Okay, so second trade was the pursuit, and then he gets blipped to that planet with Stiltman. Okay, that's the whole second trade. The third trade is when they finally get to Tatu.
This was the overpriced extra length trade.
Yes.
Clearly a trade of, let's get this shit over with, I think.
Except it doesn't. So they get to Tatu, they fight Korvac and his dudes, right? There's lots of, they're like racing to the power, the MacGuffin, mm-hmm. right? Like they're...
I've got the power.
Yeah, his band of misfits are fighting their band of misfits. Tony Black, you know, you think that Korvac's down, and then he's like crawling, and Iron Man's like, we can't stop him. He's going to get there. The only way to do it is for me to jump in there too. So they basically jump in this power cosmic together, and that's why this third trade's called Cosmic Iron Man. It's because he becomes Cosmic Iron Man. Mm-hmm. He absorbs the power cosmic. Korvac absorbs the power cosmic, and they basically just duke it out like his two cosmic gods. Except Kofu doesn't draw these issues.
I think there's Angel Unzueta.
Yeah, and he
does a bunch of the issues.
He does a...
There is some alternating, though. I think that they tag team a little bit.
Yeah, and unfortunately, just as the beginning, it says who all the artists are, but they don't show before each issue. Anyway, Iron Man, Korvac duke it out. Iron Man actually ends up turning him over to the Living Tribunal and the Beyonder and Death and all the big...
The cosmic guys.
The big cosmic guys. Yeah. They, like, turn Korvac over to him. There's a scene where when they're fighting, he, like, smashes Korvac. I know what he does. He takes him to this dead realm, and apparently it's from Cantwell's Doctor Doom. I think it's from Cantwell's Doctor Doom, or he read about it when he was doing research for his series. I don't know. Doctor Doom apparently killed an entire dimension. It's got nothing in it. So Iron Man, knowing about this dimension, banishes Korvac to there. He's like, I'm not going to kill you. I'm going to take you to just nothingness, and I'm going to leave you there.
And then he tells the cosmic people where he's
at. I think that's when they show up, and they're like, we're just going to take him. But before they get there, God damn it, there's a scene where they're fighting, and he basically, like, as they're fighting, they crash into this planet. And as the planet is being destroyed, it's like the planet Satania, Satania. I don't know if this planet existed in the MCU beforehand. It obviously doesn't matter. But it's like one dude.
Well, MU, we should say.
Yeah. Old habits die hard.
You say Marvel Comics universe, but we don't.
So basically, Tony and the Beyond, and I almost said the Beyonder, and Korvac are fighting.
There's good reason to be thinking about the Beyonder over the course of the story, but carry on.
So as they're fighting, they end up crashing into this planet. So this little side story that's running underneath Tony and Korvac fighting is this guy seeing his planet about to get destroyed. He jumps in an escape capsule, and he's the only person that escapes the planet. And then he basically lands at some other planet, and he gets in there, and he's like, he's got like a USB, I think, with all of the history for his. So I narrowly escaped that Hollow Universe back into this one, but I still found my home of Draconius no more. I came here to Satania. My drone spent a fuel. I guess Satania is where he lands. His planet was Draconius. But now, even I feel my last breath as I write these final words on our great history. What will the Iron God bring to his homeworld? I know what he and Korvac brought to mine, death. And then he just dies in this bar bleeding. Mm. So it's like, again, like right. Tony's just trying to beat Korvac.
Right.
But we have to make sure we go out of our way to show you that even while Tony's trying to defeat Korvac, they wiped this guy's whole planet off, and we have to watch him die at a table as he's writing the final words. Like, I'm not trying to oversell the Tony can't do anything right in this book, because we're now, that's issue 15. We're over a year into this run, and they're still, like, heavy-handed with this kind of stuff, right? So then he becomes Cosmic Iron Man. He goes back to Earth, and he continues to fuck shit up. So he's trying to fix everybody's problems, because he thinks that he can make a better utopia.
Well, he's got all this godlike power. He's not going to just renounce it. He's going to do something positive with it. As you pointed out, this whole time he keeps trying to do right and everything gets fucked up. But now that he's a cosmic being, he's going to finally get it right and do it the correct way. And my understanding is that he proceeds to give the entire Earth Tony Stark level intellect.
Right. So he's there with the Avengers because he's like, look, I'm not going to make all of my ideas. And the way he actually rationalizes it is actually not bad. He was like, I can't have all the great. He goes, I may have the intellect, but maybe I don't have the ideas to apply my intellect. He's like, everybody has great ideas. They just don't have the intellect to execute it. So if I give everyone my intellect, then all of these great ideas on the planet can be done, right? It's kind of an interesting way to think about it. So he imbues everybody on planet Earth with, actually, I think he was doing like a pilot in just New York first to see how it would go. And he literally says, so the Fantastic Four there. And Sue goes, wait, we're all, Reed, do you feel different? And he goes, I actually think I just became dumber.
Yeah, I love that.
And it's just like, it's a funny line. Yeah. But at the same time,
opportunity to show Tony Stark yet again.
It's right. It's like by the time you're at this point, you're in issue 16 or 17, and you're like, oh my god, we get it, dude. Like, we get it, right? So then there's like all these hijinks where all these people, like, there are car mechanics who are now who know everything, and like, kids are playing.
The big wheel is on a rampage, and him and Hellcat stop him, and it turns out he was figuring out how to end congestion.
Right, end all traffic congestion, and they actually stopped him when they shouldn't have, and all sorts of stuff. Right, so it's all the same thing. So they show up. And they figure out, who can we get to help, like, solve this Tony Stark problem now? Mm. And they realize it's, like, Dr. Doom. They get Dr. Doom to help them kind of sort this stuff out.
Wasn't there some kind of thing, too, where people fall under his sway when they're in his proximity or something? And he was, like, one of the only guys who can, like, has the ego to not be swayed?
Yeah, well, that, and Hellcat wasn't either. She wasn't swayed by it either.
Well, Hellcat's the one who enlists Dr. Doom in the first place.
Right, right. But she, no, because she's all, like, when they come out here, and they get Silver Surfer, too. They're basically, like, whenever Tony Tony comes out, we all just have to agree with him and say, yeah, because that's what he does. Then it turns into, everyone agree with me. Stop disagreeing with me. Because the power starts getting away from him.
He gets musky.
Right. Musky. Trying to date this podcast.
I do think that Elon Musk's implosion is going to be one of those Howard Hughes kind of things where people will be referencing it for a long time.
He ends up having a knockdown drag out with all of his buddies. He kills them all.
Right. Well, I mean, the knockdown is he hits them and they go down.
Right.
It's what I remember is like he punches Rhodey and his head flipped the other way. Yeah.
Head spins the wrong way. He like blows.
Shreds Gargoyle, like shatters him like a statue.
He melts Silver Surfer. Like he kills everybody, right? And then he goes, I can undo it. Because Korvac did the same thing back in the 70s. In the mm-hmm. He undoes it, but then he has to make the decision. And he realizes that he needs to just give the power up. Like he
one of the big questions is he can revive his friends, but does he let them remember that he killed them in the first place?
Right. And he decides that he needs to. He needs to let them remember.
Well, I think Patsy helps him decide that he needs to. They need to know what he was capable of under those circumstances.
Right. So he does. He brings him back. And that's kind of the Korvac. Doesn't Korvac show back up at the end?
Yeah.
By the end of it, it was like, oh, he's back again.
How do they explain that?
Fuck, I can't. Oh, no. I think he killed or he escaped. He was powerful enough to escape them all. He beats Iron Man's ass and then picks him up and takes him to the hospital.
Well, at this point, Tony's already renounced the power and he's like in super masochist mode. So he's like allowing Korvac to beat him to death without defending himself, which is something that rattles Korvac.
We totally forgot something else. And maybe you didn't catch it because you were skimming it. He gets addicted to morphine.
Oh, yeah. That's
how did I forget to bring
it? Because he broke his neck, which we also forgot to mention.
Earlier in the book, he breaks his neck. So they set up his armor to give him like a slow morphine drip, except whenever he's like adrift in space.
He turns that shit off.
He cranks it up.
Well, no, he turns off the regulator.
He turns the governor off, right? Yeah. Because he's like, I just need to make it to Tatu to help fight Korvac. So he basically knows he's getting like addicted to it, right? And he becomes a fucking junkie.
Yeah. And at one point, Patsy, because Patsy's making contact with him in this realm through her telepathy, which has been restored and augmented by Moondragon, because they make a point of having one of the little asterisks editor's note. She had her mental powers taken away from her by Moondragon and New Defenders number 116 or some shit like that. And Moondragon basically says that you guys are not going to be able to defeat Korvac unless you have your telepathy, because it's going to be key to everything we have to do. And with that new super powerful telepathy, she's able to reach to apparently another dimension or some shit and converse with Iron Man. And Iron Man is like giving her some kind of spiel. And she's like, okay, I know you've turned off your governor. How high are you right now? And he's like, I'm so high.
He's extremely fucked up. Anyway, so that's
when he renounces, he's got like powers, he's also going into severe morphine withdrawal.
So after, he renounces his powers. He's just like, you know what? I'm sorry. I fucked everything up again. I'm a huge, because we're now 2 years into this run and he's made no progress as a human being, right?
Well, he's gotten worse. He murdered all of his.
He's gotten worse.
Became God.
Very much worse. So finally, he just walks away from Patsy. He's stumbling through Central Park. He gets held up by a dude and then he just gives the guy his wallet.
Yeah.
He gets held up at knife fork.
There's more where that came from.
Gives his wallet. Then he passes out from the withdrawals. That's when Korvac shows up as he's passed out, like dying from morphine withdrawal. And he's like, Korvac's just like trashing him, like talking shit to him or whatever. And he's just like, Stark, the wind outside. He's like, Stark, like, hello. And then he's like, Stark. And he's just like slapping him and trying to get him to wake up to like, hey, like, let me kick your ass. And he's just like, I'm a junkie. He's just like, yeah. Okay. Like as the Korvac, you see all this text from Korvac, like all, you know, he's just like talking. And Tony's just going, okay. Yeah. Well, he's like, what's happening to you? That's what he just tells him. He's like, dude, I'm like, I'm a junkie. I'm going through withdrawal. So basically, instead of Korvac like killing him, he feels sorry for him, picks him up and takes him to the hospital. Right. So he can rehab. Although I do think, doesn't Korvac give up his powers first? And then not yet. Korvac gives up his powers, punches Tony once. Or actually, he starts just beating him man to man, almost beats him to death. Then picks him up when he realizes he can't even fight back. Takes him to the hospital. And then it appears Korvac goes and commits suicide.
Yeah, it looks but they like don't he really steps show. Off a ledge, but it's not explicitly shown that he dies. And there's just some question about that. Yeah, it's not clear.
Yeah, but he takes him to the hospital
first. It's implied.
But that's how it ends. It ends with Patsy picking him up from the hospital, taking him to rehab.
Yeah, and there's a big thing about how, has he proposed to... marriage to her yet?
I don't know if that was yet or not. She tells him no.
Yeah.
Spoiler. Yeah, he proposes to her and she's like, nope.
Yeah, and see, that was one of the things that was interesting to me is that I knew that Patsy had been a regular character in the new Iron Man series and I'm seeing all those gorgeous Alex Ross covers and so it's like, I'll get around to it, you know. We hadn't been covering comic books in a while. I didn't have any real good reason to just like keep checking out the 2020 Iron Man series, right? So when I read that in the previews catalog or whatever, I'm like, oh shit, she might actually be end up marrying Iron Man, that could be kind of a big deal. And then when I'm looking at it in this book, it's like literally it asked and answered in like one issue. She's like, nah, dog. You know, it's just like, okay, well, I guess that wasn't as big of a deal as I thought it was going to be. And then there's this whole thing where, will you take me to rehab? Yes, you're the only person I would ask to do this. And you're the only person I'd ask to come pick me up. And she picks him up 3 months later because he needed to stay longer to because he felt like he needed more time. And they just make this big deal about her being like the one and only person that he could rely on and count and be comfortable with, exposing this vulnerability and having her take him in and out of rehab. And of course, she's on the cover to that Iron Man trade you've got, although that's got to be probably the worst cover of the run. And it's this weird thing where I think he's like trying to channel Gene Colan drawing Hellcat. And it just looks kind of weird. Her legs look floppy like the dummy from the Sabotage video.
So it's the beginning of the last trade when he proposes to her. It's when she picks him up from rehab that he proposes to her.
Yeah.
And then she doesn't really like give him an answer at first, which is never a good sign. Hey, right.
And also, I'm
guys
not
out
sure
there. Guys and gals.
Marry the morphine addict fresh out of rehab.
Who's making like rash decisions now that he's back being reintroduced into society. And then the rest of the book is kind of like, what is this fucking last story about? It's they find out that one of Iron Man's old dudes from the Michelini days turned into like a weapons broker. Mm-hmm. And he called Tony and Rhodey and left them a voicemail saying he needed to talk to them. And it's because he had purchased on the black market the Mandarin's rings. And then the dude gets
right.
fucking
and
murdered.
And that dude, I think, was from some previous run.
He's from the Michelini run.
And then of course he's killed at some point, or they say he's been killed. And then some villain turns up with the rings. I thought it was Carbon Man. What is that guy's name? Cobalt Man.
Okay, this last story. I had to kind of refresh my memory on it. I apologize.
I can understand why, though, because it very much is like, here's the Cantwell run, ending with him going into rehab. Oh shit, we are filling four more issues of some bullshit.
Yeah.
Clearly,
because the last issue is total filler and doesn't have to. Yeah. So it's literally a four issue.
Literally,
story.
Like they're building up to the legacy number 65, 650.
Yeah.
And the volume number 25, but he's run out of story with issue 21. And then you've got this thing where it's like, what is this? What's going on here? You know, it's just, and the Hellcat pretty much mostly disappears from that final arc.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Because they're like, they don't even talk anymore. I think he says, I haven't talked to her in a while at some point.
Right. Yeah.
That might have been.
I was going to marry her, but now we're not really talking that much.
Well,
which is typically what happens.
No. She said no. Okay. So the gist of the story is that Tony finds out there's a black market for super weapons. Okay. And the Mandarin's rings happen to have been on that thing. One of their buddies got killed for it. So he, Rhodey, I think that's the dude Force. Is that his name?
From the late Michelini.
Yeah. So they get their buddy Force.
Mark Bright days, right?
Yeah. Yes. He is, they have him be like the buyer. Tony funds it. And they basically say, you're going to go and we're just going to buy all this shit. He's like, I will use every dime I have to just buy. And what we're going to do is we're going to store it and then eventually destroy it. Tear it down and destroy it. It's almost like a bootleg Armor Wars, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I was definitely thinking Armor Wars when you were mentioning it.
So anyway,
hey, shit, they're still going to make an Armor Wars movie. Fuck.
I don't want to talk about that. So they're doing these deals, shady shit going on. They're trying to figure out who killed their guy. They're trying to get Mandarin's rings. Bethany Cabe pops up and she's the one like managed another. Michelin
really threw me off because
she looks like Patsy Walker.
Yeah, I'm skimming through the books. It's like, oh, there's the redhead. And I start reading. He's like, wait, Bethany Cabe?
Riri Williams shows up.
More than shows up, she's the Cobalt Man. She takes off the helmet.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm here to help. It's like, what the fuck? Riri Williams has not appeared in this entire run.
And doesn't she keep the 10 rings at the end of it or something?
Something like that.
Yeah, it's like they have to like make a deal to figure out who's going to keep the 10 rings.
And she's just like, unilaterally, I am.
Turns out Force had betrayed them. He was actually, it was bullshit the whole time. Mm-hmm. And he was actually working for the bad guys. It's a whole bunch of stuff, guys. It's not a bad little story, but it's not. It's four issues out of what I'm telling you is a 25 issue run. We're not going to spend too much
time. Well, and also, like, do they have the rest of 650 in there, or do they just stop with the little Cantwell 3 to 5 pages that are in issue number 25? Because there's a whole thing where, like, Kurt Busiek does a retro story where it's supposed to be, like, another Tales of Suspense
that's
issue that never came out.
That's in here, too.
That looked kind of cool. I didn't read that, though.
Didn't read
it. Because it didn't have Hellcat, and that's what I'm here for. And then they had, like, some the Space Tony thing or something, as I remember correctly.
Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
So the last story is, it's called Iron Man Day. Okay. And there's basically like a Iron Man Day in the city of New York, right? Yeah. Right? Where they're gonna, and the whole issue is Iron Man not wanting to go to Iron Man Day.
Right.
And he's basically finding anything else he can do instead of going to Iron
Man
Day.
I'm not worthy.
Because that's what it is. Yeah. He feels like he doesn't like the attention, that it's all he does is screw everything up. He shouldn't be doing this. Yeah, he shows up and they're doing like the sibilance mic check. And he's like, I can't do this. And he just leaves. He goes down down in the subways and finds a junkie overdosing. He takes him to the hospital. Junkie ends up dying. And then at the end of it, it's just like he missed the entire day. He gets back to his house. Hellcat's there. The Avengers are there. And they say, Happy Iron Man Day, Tony. And then it's like he remembers that, oh, he does have friends out there who actually care about him. But he fucked over the entire city and did not show up to Iron Man Day at any point. Right. Like, it's really...
And also some of these people he killed in the last few months.
Yeah. So that's where the 25-issue arc ends.
Yeah. So I've been somewhat openly critical over the course of this discussion. You've been a little bit more cagey.
So the first trade, I was fully on board. The second trade, the Stiltman arc, threw me for a loop, but it was weird enough that I was sort of like, you know what? This is still just like different Iron Man. You know what? Every character that's been around since the 60s is going to go through some weird stuff. When it turned out that the blip that sent him there was just Stiltman pulling him out of the story that's been dragging at that point, and then they just put him back. That was a little annoying. Like, I thought that Korvac had sent him there, or, you know, there was a reason for him to have been there. And when you find out it was just like a complete side story and just to take him out of the picture for a while.
And let's not forget that Stiltman, having been a Marvel villain for a long time, having a pretty decent idea of the hierarchy of power in the Marvel universe, we probably know that if somebody's going to fuck up his whole deal, it's going to be somebody like Tony Stark.
It's going to be Tony Stark.
So don't bring Tony Stark.
Who is intimately familiar with the Ultimos.
This is a D-Man situation, okay? Yeah. Hell, you could maybe even bring Rhodey, maybe. Although, let's face it, at some point, Tony's going to find Rhodey if you take Rhodey. Don't bring the super genius who is going to unravel your scheme.
Yeah. So that was annoying.
No, you don't, like, text the mystery machine to come by your haunted amusement park, you know?
Yeah. So, but then, you know, him getting the power cosmic was cool. The cosmic armor was a little strange looking. It actually looked a little bit like Will Portacio's Iron Man Heroes Reborn armor mixed with the Superior Iron Man armor a little bit. Like, it was kind of weird looking. It had like a mouth.
Silvery energy wave.
It had like a weird like mouth lip thing. It's kind of bizarre. But it was kind of cool watching him make these decisions. Like I said, kind of out of the box. So I'll just give everybody Iron Man's thing, although they kind of shit on him. And then it kind of all falls apart from there. You know, he proposes to Patsy and she like turns him down, which was some fucked up shit. Which one was like, okay, well, that was a choice, right? Like, it's not, you know, Elaine and Jerry aren't going to get married in the final episode of Seinfeld. Like, nope, you know what? She sees you're fucked up. She knows she's fucked up. The morphine addiction. It just is.
Do we need another one of these?
Do we need another one of the, yeah. the more like.
How many demons and how many bottles?
Korvac didn't kill him because he felt bad for him because he was a junkie.
Right.
It's how he defeats Korvac.
Admittedly, people who have addictive personalities also have a tendency toward backsliding too. But we've done that a bunch of times too.
I got to find a line in this comic book that I forgot about that was sort of, that was like a... Like, ooh, kind of a... Give me one sec. I liked that there was a straight-up Patsy and Hetty flashback where she... Or a dream sequence, kind of.
Yeah.
They talk about Hellstrom. That kind of stuff pops up in here, which I appreciate from the Hellcat perspective that... Well, they didn't go tons into it, but the fact that it even was... That came up about how her mom was a writer and all... actually put some Hellcat lore in here.
So Hellcat's been around throughout this two-year run. She doesn't take it over. She is an important part of the run. But there are whole issues where she's barely or not in it at all. So she has one spotlight issue, and it's not the entire issue either. There's still Iron Man content within the issue. But during the period where Moondragon is trying to unlock her telekinetic or telepathic abilities, she has her go into the past and deal with all these dream states. She goes back to Centerville, which is the setting for the old Patsy and Hetty comic books. She is using her telepathy against one of her teachers, and then ultimately she runs into a Damon Hellstrom, who's like the principal of the school. And it's all this psycho play to get her to a place where she finally accepts the flaws in herself. Like, there's a sequence where her mom has her, she's already been rendered comatose and she's lying on her bed. And her mom is talking about how she's written all these stories about the perfect version of Patsy that she wanted instead of the actual human being that's in her life. And in fact, there's a story, I think it's part of the miniseries. And so Patsy's dealing with never being the idealized daughter that her mother wanted. And the mother is basically like, I'm looking forward to her killing herself so that I don't have to deal with this person anymore. I can just deal with the idealized version of my stories. And somebody comes to her bed and gives her a straight razor in order to facilitate her suicide. And ultimately, the dream Patsy is in an asylum. And then the modern Patsy goes to the asylum with Moondragon, unbinds her from her straitjacket, accepts her, and her ability to accept her past self and her flaws allows her to finally unlock the telepathy that helps her and Iron Man to defeat Korvac.
I can't find it. Doesn't matter. There's a line where somebody says something about how it's sort of like a gonna kill yourself or you're gonna get yourself killed or something like that. And she's like, don't ever use kill yourself around me ever, or something like that. And it's just like, ugh, like, cause she killed herself. Right. It's like a little too on the nose with the joke. Like, give me a break. You remember it was Gargoyle, et cetera. Rhodey made a comment. It was just like,
I actually think that might have been during the plane ride.
I don't remember. It's too many issues. It's 25 issues. I'm not gonna flip through.
So this gets back to the Aspen. So what's fucking with me while I'm reading this material is that he's got an asterisk to the issue of Patsy and Hetty number 95, apparently, that where she's the valedictorian of her class and shit. And, you know, specifically naming the issue of Defenders where her powers were taken away by Moondragon and all this kind of shit. So it gives you the impression that this person is well read on these characters and can make these references. Until you remember that there were tons of online resources where you could skim the Cliff Notes versions of all these characters and where they would tell you where exactly they're referencing. And it'd be extremely easy to just put that in there to look like you know what you're talking about without actually knowing what you're talking about. Because my feeling is that if you read Patsy and Hetty comic books like I did, I'm not somebody who grew up on this shit. She was gone by the time I was coming into comic books. I discovered this character, like I knew she existed, I'd read some stories with her, but I started paying attention to this character during the life of this podcast because I was looking for female characters that were underrepresented in the comic books to do some spotlight episodes on so that we can have like experience diversity and show like characters that'd be cool to adapt into the MCU and that kind of shit, right? And I fell down a Hellcat hole of all this weird shit with this character and went back and read those old comic books and they're fucking great. And what makes her such a gem of a character is she's so much fun. She's so vivacious. She's her and her scheming with Hetty. It's like, they're not necessarily good people, but they're interesting people. They're fun people. They're people who love their lives and love their scheming and love their rivalry and all this kind of shit. And Steve Englehart had read those Patsy and Hetty comic books when he brought the character back in the Beast comics, the solo comics in Amazing Adventures, and then later brings her into the Avengers where she would first come in contact with Iron Man. And throughout the run of Defenders comic books that she appeared in, the main team that she was a part of, she's written by mostly David Anthony Kraft, and he's doing the whole cheese and crackers and like playing her off as sort of a goofy character who's out of her depth, but still like embracing it and loving it and like just having fun with all of her shit. So if you read any of that shit, you know that she should not be such a fucking bitch. She is such a goddamn scold. She is so depressing. Why would you, like, I feel like the marriage proposal was another instance of Tony punishing himself for all the things he's done. Like, he's gonna hook up with this person who is just constantly pointing out his flaws as another way for him to continue to beat himself up. And also, especially once they unlock the telepathy and she's doing all this cosmic shit, it's like, you're Jean Grey. You're not fucking Patsy anymore. Why don't you just have fucking Jean in this book now? This isn't the character. So this is an instance of a writer coming in, doing research in order to write the characters, which I applaud. That's better than fucking Jodi Picoult coming in from her mystery novels to have Wonder Woman not being able to pump gas, right? Infamously. But they got some, this is Marvel Starfucker bullshit. They got some guy who wrote for Halt and Catch Fire and some other TV shows, and he comes in, he writes a 15 fucking issue arc because he doesn't know how comics work, but he at least does the research, or he has an editor who's helping him to get the basics down. But I don't think he knows this shit. I don't think he knows these characters. The Tony Stark that's being represented in this arc is the Tony arc from the movies, where he's the fucker that creates Ultron, and he's the guy with the fucking, I'm gonna build a wall around the entire world to protect the Earth shit. And I'm not saying that the comics don't inform that, because Robert Downey Jr. and Jon Favreau did the fucking research. They gained an understanding of those characters while also doing things that were different for the movies to tell their own story, but it was grounded in a real knowledge of who that character was. And I think Cantwell saw the movies, did read reference material,
Cantwell did some research. And I found the line real quick, okay? So it's when they're going to Galactus's ship, and Tony beats them there because he blips in front of them, even though he hasn't been on the ship. So she's like, how the hell did he get there before us? And he says, who knows? Or it could be Korvac beat them there. Doesn't matter. He says, who knows? But the force fields, this is Rhodey, who knows? But the force fields rising directly ahead. We're going to slam into them unless we bank away. She says, and Hellcat goes, no, floor it and get inside the shields before they form. And Rhodey goes, that's suicidal. And she goes, two favors, Rhodey. One, don't use that word around me ever again. And two, hit the gas. And I was just like, yeah, dude, I was just like, let me reread this again. I'm like, what the fuck are you talking about?
Like, I did not read this run. I skimmed this run. At some point, I was trying to read at least all of the Patsy Walker dialogue. At some point, I just couldn't anymore, and that was past that point.
Okay, so I listened to an interview with Christopher Cantwell. It was on a podcast called Geek History Lessons. It was episode 330, okay? And they talk off, the first thing they talk about Dr. Doom, okay? And I kind of wasn't really listening to it. I was eating lunch. But he calls Reed Richards, and maybe you agree with this, maybe I don't know, but it was my first sort sort of like, like I had kind of paused the podcast to be like, did I just hear what he said? He calls Reed Richards an intellectual bully, which
that's fair, especially in the early years, especially like especially with Sue in the early years, he was kind of an intellectual bully.
Sure, okay, but it was sort of like that's a take.
Yeah,
okay, like that's not somebody who wants to write the Fantastic Four and make the loving family that does exploration across the universe. If you look at Reed Richards and you're like, he's an intellectual bully. When you're looking at it from the perspective of somebody who writes Doctor Doom, it's kind of like a strange thing. Like, who's
I disagree. I think that's actually probably the right take. It's sort of like,
that's fine.
Like I hate Brian Azzarello in general. I really hate his take on comic books. He's a person who hates superhero comic books and hates superheroes, but he keeps taking the money and writing them, or at least he did for a long time there. But he wrote a miniseries called Lex Luthor Man of Steel with art by Lee Bermejo, which will definitely get my ass through the door, right? And it was all about Lex Luthor looking at Superman from his perspective, even though I recognize that he's a xenophobe and he's got all these other complexes and all this kind of shit. Within the context of that story, you're kind of rooting for Lex because you can see his perspective on Superman and why he hates that person, why he sees that person as dangerous and a threat to all mankind and all this kind of other stuff. So when you're writing the villain and you're writing from the villain's perspective, I think you do have to have sympathy for the villain. You have to understand the motivations. Even if you don't like the villain, you need to understand why they do the things they do. So if you're writing a Doctor Doom series, coming at it from the perspective of Reed Richards, an intellectual bully, and I do think that Reed is more intelligent than Victor Von Doom, and I think that perhaps part of their rivalry is because Victor is smart enough to recognize that. I'm not sure because he has such an ego. And also, I'm not entirely sure that he is smarter. My perspective is I think Reed is smarter because he beats Doctor Doom. You know, that's part of it. But if you're writing Doctor Doom, yeah, you're going to look at Reed from the most negative light possible, and I could see where that would carry over into other things. But especially if you're talking about Doom, like, hi, I'm writing Doctor Doom, and I'm talking about my perspective.
That's not how it came up.
Yeah.
It was just, I don't know. He wasn't saying Doctor Doom's motivations are that how can you hate Reed Richards? Well, Doctor Doom hates Reed Richards because he was just describing Reed Richards.
Right.
And I'm like, okay, well, that's
But again, like, Brian Azzarello wrote Superman for a year, and he had no business doing that, and that story fucking sucked, and it was a waste of Jim Lee's talents drawing that character, right? Nobody loves For Tomorrow, which is the name of the 1 year he did, and a lot of the shitty Superman stuff that people hate that infused the Snyder Superman movies, and it's one of the reasons why people hate the Snyder movie so much, is not just because of what Snyder did, but because he seemed to be referencing what Azzarello did. But I thought Azzarello wrote a really great Lex Luthor miniseries because he thinks like Lex Luthor. He hates Superman. He hates superheroes. And he could effectively write that character because he's in that guy's shoes to some degree. That doesn't mean I suddenly want Azzarello to write a fucking Superman story. Fuck that guy. Fuck it, those stories. But if you're going to have him write a Lex Luthor miniseries, especially if it's drawn by Lee Bermejo, that's a good call. And it seems like with Cantwell, given the contempt he shows for Tony Stark for 2 fucking years of this series, and given the fact that he started out writing a Doctor Doom thing, and when he couldn't sustain that commercially, jumps over to an Iron Man thing and carries some of that Doctor Doomness with him, and then of course brings Doctor Doom in for a story arc, it kind of makes sense. It tracks.
So the interviewer asks him, like, what research did you do to get the laydown of, you know, Iron Man stuff? And he says that he read the Michelini Layton stuff, including Armor Wars.
But that's a lot of stuff. Did he read all the stuff, or
He had, you know, Victor, what was it, Marinelli or whatever his guy, and then he's got Bethany Cave in there for like 3 panels, right? I mean, that's some Layton era stuff. Again, that's light, you know. But he talks about the way Tony acts during Armor Wars. Now, Armor Wars is an arc, okay? It starts off with him realizing that all of these bad guys are using his technology, and then he goes a little crazy and just says, I'm going to take all my technology back. Like, you fucked with the wrong guy. Stop using my technology to hurt people, right? And he feels a little bit of responsibility for that. But then he goes a little too far and he starts fucking with people like Stingray, right? Who's the dude that goes, right?
Yeah, Stingray, red and white, yep. Underwater guy. Yeah.
He fucks Stingray up, and turns out Stingray doesn't have Stark technology. He just fucked this guy. He assumed and kind of fucked the guy up, right? But Cantwell says, he talks about how selfish Tony is in Armor Wars, and that it's a really selfish thing to think that it's his responsibility, that all these people using his technology must be using it for wrong, and that he's the only one that can fix it all, and he has to do it by taking it back. And I'm like, that wasn't Armor Wars at all. Like, I mean, it's just a really weird, I've never heard anybody describe Armor Wars the way he described Armor Wars. And I was like, okay, now these comics maybe make a little more sense. If you look at Tony as just being selfish no matter what the fuck he does, he went rogue in, because he found out that S.H.I.E.L.D. stole all of his fucking technology. And he's like, fuck you, Nick Fury. I'm taking, no, you can, your mandroids can't have Stark technology. I did not allow you to have that. So I'm taking it the fuck back. So he develops that neuralizer that neutralizes Tony Stark, that Stark-based technologies, right? Like, what the fuck are you talking about? How is that Tony being selfish? They stole his this technology and they're using it to hurt people. I'm sorry, like, that's a pretty basic thing. Again, then it does go to his head. That's the arc of a character. That's when you tell a story and then he realizes he's gone too far by the end of it, right? Like, that's how it goes, as opposed to a story where a character doesn't evolve for the entire story arc, where they enter it one type of way and they stay that way the entire time and get worse throughout it, right? So as soon as I heard him describe Armor Wars that way, I was like, oh, you know what? The Dodge Aspen might be clowning him. He put him in a Dodge Aspen because he's a clown and he was trying to make Tony look like a clown. He put him in that scene on the airplane to make him look like a clown, right? And Christopher Cantwell is actually Hellcat in this book, shitting on Tony on all the pages. I will say, so I would say if you had been reading Iron Man nonstop and you'd suffered through several other runs in a row, like the Bendis stuff and the Dan Slott stuff that was allegedly so bad, and then you get to this stuff and you're like, yes, a fresh start, that's what we're all looking for, and then you got this stuff, I could absolutely see how you would make a celebratory YouTube video saying how awful it was that this dude's finally gone. I could see that. Myself as being somebody who's like, none of these are my Iron Man. These are all what ifs to me, as far, you know, my Iron
Your
Man.
Your period has already ended.
My period has ended. I have no stake in this. I have no right to complain about this stuff, right? I'll say that I thought that the writing for the most part was fine in trade setting. If I was waiting every month if this took 2 years to tell.
You're paying $4. We say 2 years because it's 25 issues. This is Marvel comic book, modern comic books. I don't know how long this shit actually took. I'm not sitting there and doing the math on it. It could have been gaps in between there as well.
Like that Stiltman story.
Yeah. Month after month of that shit. Month after month. Tony in a hut doping up.
Yeah, getting hot, getting super fucking hot.
And fighting Ultimos.
And fighting Ultimos. He didn't even recognize it first. And it was like, I recognize Ultimo on that first page. How did Tony recognize it?
Right,
I could see how it could be great.
The part where Stiltman learns how to control or construct Ultimos, I didn't miss that part. How did that happen again?
Well, he learned how to turn them on and operate them is basically all it is.
Okay.
Yeah. I could see how if you read that monthly, it'd be grating. For me, it wasn't as bad, but reading it all in one sitting, the harshness of Patsy towards Tony and the woe is me, Tony, it got pretty... At first, I was intrigued by it because I wanted to see where it would go. And when it just didn't go anywhere, except that then he gets the power cosmic and becomes an even bigger asshole and never like learns a lesson. Like, when did he learn a fucking lesson? And then the whole arc or the whole writing tenure ends with him skipping Iron Man Day and not wanting to be there, you know, and still not wanting to be a hero. And you know what I mean? It was kind of like, what was the fucking point other than to just have him shit on for 2 years? And he just had him shit on for 2 years. He just fucked up. He ignored his friend's phone call and it got him killed in the Mandarin Ring weapons trading store. He ignored the guy's call and got him killed. Like, it's just, it didn't stop. It was like relentless. So with that, it was kind of fucked up. I would not say this is anywhere near my favorite Iron Man. I don't know if I would even reckon. I wouldn't, if you can get these from the library.
You hate Tony Stark and want to see him shat upon, or if you hate, like, if you're like a glass onion person and you loved watching Edward Norton play a shittier, or what seemed like a shittier version. Actually, he seems like the better version of Elon Musk at this point. If you got off on that, you might get off on reading this as well. But why would you want to? Why would you want to read about a person
hate?
It's
pretty.
Why would you want to write a person that you hate?
So if you want to go if you want to talk about Kafu, you're right. It's not super shiny, blingy armor. And it is a contrast with the Alex Ross, like, limitless metal.
Could
on
not
the
be more dissimilar. Right. Although it does have a painterly quality to it.
Yeah. I really enjoyed it. It's a little stiff. It's a little pin-up-y, but I find it to be rather attractive artwork. Like, was the least of my complaints.
And there were another couple of artists in the run that I thought were also quite
And they were
good.
Also good.
I think Unzueta was good, and there was another person as well that I liked.
Yeah, Unzueta went...
I don't remember any of the issues having outright bad art, except toward the end, the last arc.
There might have been a couple.
Art. Yeah.
But
another reason why it's like, that it felt like this weird vestigial element, you know.
They did a good job, and I don't know if it was by... I don't know if it was colorists or what it was, but they did a good job that even when they were filling artists...
I think Kafu does their own colors. Because there's a certain coloring that person always gets that I think that's a full art. So it's almost like maybe they're drawing in pencils or something, like colored pencils or something.
D'Armada, maybe? Who did... it doesn't matter. But whoever... The art, even when it changed artists, it was never jarring. Kafu was definitely the best of the art, interior artists here. But whatever changes, it was not jarring. I think the Alex Ross armor looks great.
I mean, that's got to be one of the most gorgeous runs of covers that Iron Man's ever had, certainly.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. It looks so good.
Especially when he turns into Cosmic Iron Man and the covers where he's fighting Korvac, they're outrageous.
Yeah.
Outrageous. Like, I don't know if there's a poster series you can buy of these, dude. They look incredible.
And see, this thing, too, I've talked about this in the past, is that I think that Alex Ross loves the DC Universe more than he loves the Marvel Universe. I think that that's been expressed a number of times. He was at DC for quite a few years before he kind of got tired of them and pitched Deuce. But his style, that ultra-realistic style, works so much better for Marvel characters, because Marvel characters being grounded in reality just suits that universe so well. Drawing them ultra-realistic is perfect. And he's just, you know, his Doctor Strange covers were incredible. His Fantastic Four covers. My favorite, though, the Black Panther stuff he's done is just unreal. Just gorgeous, gorgeous stuff. I don't read very many monthly comic books anymore, but I was definitely tempted solely because his covers were so damn good. So it definitely, it's easy to look past other failings when the covers are that fantastic.
Yeah. So, I mean, if you want these just to flip through because they're pretty, I could totally see that too. And again, yeah, like if you're not a big Iron Man fan, you might actually dig this, because it takes a cynical look at who Tony Stark is. But if you're like, okay, this is a really cynical look, I can't wait to see where the character learns a lesson by the end of it, I got bad news for you. It doesn't really happen. And that's kind of what I was disappointed. I was hoping that a lot of the criticism came from those first early issues, and nobody gave it the benefit of the doubt to actually watch him turn by the end of it. And I mean, unless I missed it, I don't see it. I don't see where he ever doesn't become a piece of shit. I don't see where he ever isn't kind of a sniveling, confidenceless, lost, you know.
The poor little rich boy.
Yeah, he's poor little rich boy. That airplane scene is cruel. It's like cruel. And she's just like shitting on him. Well, he's like, why can't I lean my seat back? And they're like, well, they're not going to bring you champagne floats. You don't own this jet. And it's just like, good Christ. Like, you know, this Iron Man, he saved the fucking world a trillion goddamn times. Can you be a little nicer to the guy? Hey, Patsy, you exist because Iron Man has probably saved the planet at least half a dozen times, okay? If by himself, fuck with the Avengers. We're not even going to add those times. Like, but it's just like, who cares? Let's forget about all that. This dude this is a hero that has never done anything good ever. Even looking at it as a what if, it got hard by the end of it.
So I got to point out again, I didn't read this run. I skimmed this run. What I had read was they released the Iron Man and Hellcat Annual. This was released in 2022. Art on this one is by Ruairi Coleman. Not familiar, but I'm not familiar with most artists these days. I chose the Peach Momoko cover because it was cool. And I was wanting it because, like, okay, there's a comic book with Hellcat in it titular co-star.
That is cool.
I'm going to pick this up. I had picked up the Kate Leth series. We'd actually recorded, because I'd had you read the first issue. I don't know what happened to that recording. I can't find it. And I'd read the series, but I'd lost interest because the character was too frivolous. It was a situation where I want to see Patsy being a fun-loving character who embraces being a superhero, but, you know, but also is elevated, because she is somebody who's been with Marvel almost since the very beginning. She's a character who financially helped support Marvel for a number of years, and then she got involved with a lot of the superhero stuff, and she just has one of the coolest, weirdest histories of any character ever. So I'd like to see her promoted to the upper tiers of Marvel and let her be an Avenger or whatever, build her up. And the problem that I have is, like, they're aggressively marginalizing this character over the years. Even though she's hanging out with Iron Man for a 2-year run, she's basically there to just be this scold that makes Tony feel like shit the entire time, right? Well, in her last series, and they use the font, the logo from the Patsy Walker Hellcat series on that cover, this story is about her going back to live in her mother's house for reasons I don't remember, and there's a bunny rabbit in the house that turns out to have the soul of Damon Hellstrom in it. Patsy is being haunted by all kinds of ghosts, and I think that her ex-husband Mad Dog shows up at one point, but now he's like a were-Mad Dog, and she's seeing these images of herself with cat claws and being possessed by demons, and Hetty's there with her, and there's some question about maybe Hetty's involved with the visions she's having and stuff, and it's all this really grimdark stuff, and it's tying in closely with the events of the Hellstorm ongoing series and a lot of stuff that they were dealing with in the annuals where they revive the character. They bring that up over and over again. I have to point out that we talked about those annuals almost a decade ago. Those books were like a decade plus old when we did that, so we're talking about annuals from like 2000, 2003, somewhere in there. I would hope that some somebody like Patsy Walker would have maybe moved on from that, maybe reclaimed some of her old happy-go-lucky stuff. But no, it's all about her still crying about hell and all her bad marriages and everything else, just kind of wallowing in this shit. And then again, I get the Peach Momoko cover for the miniseries that spins off that's also by Christopher Cantwell. I should point out that that annual takes place around the time or slightly before Iron Man number 20. So the annual is kind of explaining her absence, and I assume that the miniseries might also do that as well. Now, the miniseries is drawn by Alex Linz. The annual is in a more cartoony style. I mean, it's lighter, so it's kind of a contrast between this grimdark elements and the art being pretty and kind of happier looking artwork, where this one is a darker from the very beginning, more raw, and she's still in the house and she's still being haunted, but also apparently at some point, like, she had been a private investigator working for the law firm of She-Hulk. And so she was around throughout one of those runs. I haven't read that material.
Remember hearing about that. About that.
I don't understand how she becomes a detective. I don't know where they get that from, but I haven't read the issues. I really can't comment on that. So I guess at some point she became involved with Sleepwalker, the Tom DeFalco, and Brett Blevins character.
He shows
from the
90s. Up in one of these last issues.
Yeah. Well, there's like one or two pages where in the 25th issue where it's sort of saying, hey, continue the story in the ongoing or the Hellcat miniseries.
That's
right?
This series.
And of course they gave her a new logo that is like one of the shittiest, most amateur logos I've ever seen on a professional comic.
Oof.
Yeah, it's just this crappy little font.
It looks like an indie comic.
It really does look like an indie comic book. It's like, I bitch a lot about how, especially DC, just like they just want to use fonts for all their logos now. And they look so fucking boring. And it just completely turns me off. I literally
just want to show you how great Iron Man's logo has always been. Not always, but this one in particular looks great. Whether it had the rivets
on it. Isn't
that
a revival of his 90s logo or one of his 90s logos? Yes. Yeah.
Oh, it's good. It does have the rivets on it. My bad. They're just colored, man.
Yeah, looks great. It's like JLA, the Grant Morrison, Howard Porter run. They did like some kind of an omnibus at one point in time. I wanted to buy it, but the cover had the JLA in a font. And I'm like, I'm not giving you $150 for you to do this fucking bullshit Microsoft Word logo.
Sans
shit,
serif,
right?
Yeah. Bold, underline.
I love the JLA Shield logo. I adore that. I bought so many fucking comics in the late 90s, early 2000s, because it had that shield on it. And that meant I was going to buy it because I was all in for that period of JLA. I loved it. I still think that's the most perfect Justice League run. So they recently solicited a new series of collections that they're just going to be regular trade paperbacks, although they'll be thicker. And this is the first time they're going to collect the miniseries and the specials and shit. Apparently those weren't in the omnibuses or the previous JLA runs. And I was on the fence because I'm like, well, if they're doing that, they'll probably eventually do an omnibus of that and I'll just get that omnibus. But I'm not 100% that they're going to do that. And these books have the JLA shield on them. I'm like, fuck me. I'm going to buy this for the fucking logo. That's been my one bitch. I haven't bought, because I don't have a comprehensive collection of those issues anymore. I sold the individual issues when I had my shop. I picked up some of the trades. I don't have all the trades. So I literally don't possess a bunch of those comic books I have such affection for. But knowing that there's going to be a trade paperback set that's going to have the logo on it, and it's also going to collect the material that I still have floppies of, like the Paradise Lost I've got the floppies of still, because it was never collected, to my knowledge, ever, anywhere. Well, now they're going to collect it. So now I've got but one of the reasons is for the fucking logo, because DC hopefully finally learned the lesson. Put my fucking great logo on my cover so they can fully fulfill my nostalgia and buy that shit. And Marvel's been better. They went back to, because they did their font shit for a while there too, but they've gone back to logos and they'll recycle old logos. But the logos look cool,
They're great.
That fucking Iron Man 90s logo with the Alex Ross covers.
Yeah.
Excellent. Chef kiss. But then they give this shitty fucking, and Hellcat's never had a good logo in her entire career. She never had one. But this one's really fucking bad. So please don't do this. It makes me not want to buy your comic book because the logo is that fucking ugly. So again, at some point she hooked up with Sleepwalker and it's like, this isn't helping. You know, this isn't, you're not getting any cred. And apparently they've taken, because I don't know a ton about Sleepwalker, I never read that shit, but apparently he's like a cop from the dream dimension, and apparently he's been stripped of his badge and left in an asylum because they've accused him of murdering the guy that Patsy hooked up with after the Iron Man annual. And so the whole miniseries is the mystery of who killed this guy, and like also Patsy dealing with the trauma that she apparently was helping a guy cheat in school because she was smart, but she didn't have resources and she's working at a burger place. And so she was making extra money by helping people write their term papers and stuff. Anyway, apparently there was some kind of a cheating scandal and this one guy gets blamed for it. And so he gets into a fight and he gets mad. So he breaks a bottle and stabs a guy in the fucking throat in high school and the guy dies. And the dude's like running from the cops and I think he dies running from the cops and like his spirit's still mad at Patsy. And it's like, does Patsy not have enough emotional baggage without you throwing this extra fucking bullshit at her? But what's even worse is much of the time Patsy, like at one point, is like essentially killed and resurrected directed again. She's being guided the entire time by the Damon Hellstrom Bunny Rabbit doll. And also, like, Blackheart's involved in this a whole bunch. And that's one thing is, like, Mephisto was kind of tied into some of her Hell Resurrection shit. I don't remember Blackheart being involved, unless she was in the miniseries that I haven't read yet that Englehart did in the early 2000s with Breyfogle. But, like, so I've got all these characters that are from non-Patsy Walker things, like, being involved in the Patsy Walker story and essentially solving the mystery for her.
She's straight up like at one of the Midnight Suns now in this book.
Yeah, essentially. Like, ultimately, I think it's Dream, the Sleepwalker, who figures out that actually the guy that she was dating was, like, doing hypnotic suggestions while she was asleep and able to control her memories of events. He's trying to build some sort of, like, vessel that will allow him to go into the Hell Dimension or some shit, compromising Blackheart, like he was going to die because they were using his heart as part of it, but he needed this, like, Princess of Hell because she was married to Damon Hellstrom, so he was using her to get to the Hell Dimension and also to learn, like, what happened to his parents or some shit like that. And then eventually the Bunny Rabbit turns back into Damon Hellstrom because Damon's also been manipulating things so that he can come back from a Hell Dimension. And Patsy gets turned into, like, a werecat thing, like Tigra, the other person that had her costume before her. And so the whole thing is about how other people are doing shit and solving the mysteries for her and protecting her and carrying her or manipulating her to get what they want out of her.
She's this vessel for all this chaos for other characters
She's just this passive person in her own miniseries. And of course, the character, again, she's not vivacious. She's not fun. She doesn't have much in the way of agency. And then it ends with her like, oh, look at me. I'm jumping across the moon. I think I still have some of my, like, lame-ass cat powers. I don't know if she still has the telepathy from the Iron Man run. It's just like, who would read this and decide, who wrote this? Christopher Cantwell.
Cantwell wrote that too,
Yes, he did. So he spends...
I knew he wrote this one-shot thing, but...
He spends 2 years shitting on Iron Man, Tony Stark, and then he spins that off into a Hellcat miniseries, and he spends 5 issues an annual shitting on fucking Hellcat. Why is this guy writing superhero comic book? Why is he Azzarello-ing all over the fucking place? I've talked about this in the past. There are superheroes I don't like. One of the ones I like to point to is Cyclops, because I grew up in the era post-Byrne, where Louise Simonson and Chris Claremont were just fucking shitting on that guy for year after year. He was a fucking punching bag, right? And so he did all this reprehensible shit over those years, and it's like, no, I don't think he's a hero. And of course, over the years, they've progressed with that. Like, right before he got married to Jean Grey, he contemplated having a fling with Psylocke. And then later on, after Jean Grey dies for the final time, I think, except with her, when her teenage self came back from the past to the future, and they all were, like, being the current X-Men, and that's when Bobby becomes gay and or is outed as gay and all this other kind of bullshit. Cyclops eventually hooks up with the White Queen, making that the third telepath that he hung out with. Also, he, of course, married and had a baby with the clone of his first girlfriend. So this guy's got all kinds of twisted shit going on. I'm sorry, if telepaths existed in the real world, I don't think I would make it. There's too much sick shit floating around in my brain that I would, and just my whole issues with privacy and not wanting to be involved, like, knowing somebody could actually get inside my brain would fuck my shit up, okay? This dude goes from one telepath to another. So my first question is, he's obviously a kind of a vanilla mayonnaise kind of dude. How boring is this guy that he could hook up with all these telepaths and never have any of them be like, dude, you know, like he's comfortable in all these relationships. He must have the most boring ass life, boring ass fantasies. And then he hooks up with the White Queen, and it's like, and in fact, I think he had an affair with her before Jean Grey died. And it's like, she's pretty kinky. So, like, what was Jean not doing that she's doing to woo you, right? So Iron Man, he hooks up with Hellcat. He hooks up with her before she has telepathy, but he does try to marry her. You know what happened to that? That happened after this arc?
What's that?
He got involved with a bunch of X-Men shit. He married the White Queen.
Oh, I think I remember hearing about that.
So now Tony's on his second telepath. And I know Tony is not a pure heart, right? This is the guy who's got some deviancies, I'm sure. It just weirds me out that these guys are so into telepaths. And I just wonder about that shit. But also, it's like... I don't think Tony's a guy who would want to be with a telepath. I don't think he'd want to be with somebody who's constantly able to read any and every one of his thoughts.
I don't know, but he's got mommy daddy issues and stuff too. Maybe he needs someone that can get in there.
But you were going to read comic books where Iron Man is married to White Queen and getting involved with X-Men shit?
No.
Absolutely not, right? It's a situation where, again, it feels like somebody isn't interested enough in Iron Man to write Iron Man stories, so he's got to make it X-Men stuff, right? And so that gets back to the Cyclops thing. Despite my having prejudices against Cyclops, one of my one one of my buddies, Derek William Crabb, one of his favorite heroes is Cyclops. His icon in social media is a picture of himself at like 11 years old or some shit, wearing the Cyclops costume from the 90s or late 80s, early 90s, right? He loves Cyclops and he hates all the shit that was done to his character and he defends his character against that shit. But ultimately, Cyclops does become a villain and he does kill people and do all kinds of fucked up shit and he basically turns on the side of Magneto. So whether or not you still love that character, they fucked that character up so bad that he's now a villain, right? And that's what happens when you keep breaking characters over and over again. When you let people who have contempt for a hero that some people obviously love, and you keep going back and fucking with them, at some point they get broke. And that's why Hank Pym can't ever do anything because he slapped Janet Van Dyne the one time, which is fucked up, but you should be able to move past that, except it defined his entire character going forward. Yeah. The slap never ends. He's constantly slapping her. And of course, they've done more abusive stuff with him since then. Because like, well, if he slaps her, he probably does all this shit too.
Open up Pandora's box.
Again, Tony, he drank too much. He fucked some stuff up. He got clean, but he keeps backsliding. And now he's a morphine addict. Just now, you know, if you're going to write a hero, I'm not saying you have to hew to a rigid formula. You don't have to fucking follow, you know, Robert McKee and Joseph Campbell and all this kind of bullshit. But you have to write for the audience. You have to recognize that people love the character of Tony Stark and Iron Man. They may not have loved him a lot for all those years you suffered. And that's how you end up with a Teen Tony and a Crossing and all that other kind of bullshit.
Well, no. But there's a caveat to that he wasn't a popular character at the time. Right. So you're going to get...
But he was popular enough to support a series all those years.
Yeah, but the market was there for everybody to have a book, right? But it's... And some of that is publication due because of obligation or whatever. You know what I mean? They're like, we're not going to cancel Iron Man. But we're going to give him, like, he's going to be a teenager now. And we're going to give you just, like, no-name artists, no-name creators are going to write this book from here on out. We don't have to pay fucking anything to. Meanwhile, you know, Jim Lee's on the X-Men and shit like that. So he was tiered correctly. Iron Man currently in 2000 is more popular than Wolverine. Like mm-hmm. I had multiple Iron Men knocking on my door for Halloween. I'd have any Wolverines knocking on my door.
How many Shang-Chi's and Moon Knights and, you know.
Exactly.
Where's your Eternals representation?
That's where it doesn't make sense to me. Right. Is that when I can't think of this as, oh, this was just another run another guy had in 1997. No, I'm like, this is when Iron Man might be the most popular superhero on the face of the planet in pop culture.
Yeah.
And they're putting a writer on it who wants to torture him for 2 years and make him look like just the biggest pussy, just out of touch. Again, the airplane ride, you know, or he's trying to get in touch with himself, so I'm going to go street race and just get absolutely fucking smoked. His first race, he shows up with $5,000 like a rich douche and gets blown off the fucking streets. And it's just over and over in his fucking 78 Dodge Aspen. That's the rest of this book is Tony getting shit on in his Dodge. Sometimes it's a cosmic power Dodge Aspen, but he just look, even when the guy gets cosmic powers and becomes a god, he's fucking up and can't get out of his own way. And all of his friends are telling him that he's fucking him up, fucking up over and over and over again.
If I were to write a Cyclops book, I've said this in the past, I'm going to figure out, oh, he's an orphan. Nothing was inside of his control. So that's why he's so rigid, because he's got to be the calm in the center of a storm. And he was the leader of the X-Men for so long, and the first leader, the guy who brought those guys together. If I'm writing Cyclops, I got to figure out all the things about that character that's good, that I like. I got to figure out a way of making that character. Well, and it doesn't mean I have to fail to acknowledge all the stuff that character's gone through. But if I'm going to write that guy, I've got to figure out why people care about that character. Because my first role as the person who's been hired as the steward of this character is to serve the character and serve his audience. And see, with Iron Man, obviously I've gone through most of my life without being a huge fan of Iron Man. You know, we've talked about this. I had more interest in the character because you love the character so much. And you exposed me to some stuff. And I read some of that stuff and it didn't bowl me over, so I didn't suddenly become an Iron Man fan. But when I saw the Iron Man movie in 2008, and one of my favorite actors of all time, one of the greatest actors of his generation, is playing such a great take on Iron Man, I love that movie. And one of the problems I have with those movies is by the end of it, he's like boring married guy with a kid and stuff. It's like, you're almost 50 and you're still like gambling and partying and having all this sex and stuff. You're going to not be able to easily I don't care that you had this encounter in the desert with the terrorists and, you know, you're trying to change up your life and stuff. I can see where that would have some impact, but you're still probably going to want a bit of strange. You're still probably going to be drinking, which we see in the Iron Man 2. One of the reasons why I like Iron Man 1 and 2 and not so much 3 is because he's still figuring it out in those two movies and he's still fucking up. But ultimately, he's still the hero. He's still the guy who beats the bad guys. He still has charisma and he's fun to watch. And obviously, his politics aren't mine. The first part of the movie is him selling arms to the government. I'm not down with that. But he's still the hero of his story. And there's a place where, okay, if you find something irresponsible in like a James Bond or an Iron Man or a Wolverine because he's running around slashing these people, if you find issues with that, you can address those issues to a degree, but ultimately, you still have to continue to write that character character as somebody that people are going to like and want to read about, or you're in the wrong position. You're taking the wrong fucking job. You're doing a disservice to that character. You can address the elements of the character you don't like, but ultimately at the end of the day, you need to make sure that the people who love that character still love that character when you're done with it. And I think this is the problem, is like, you don't have an arc here. So it's a bad story. Like, if you don't have some kind of a character arc where you're at this point and then you're at this point at the end of it, and they've grown and they've changed and they've bettered themselves, or alternately, they've made themselves worse and this is the fall of the character, and you've got everybody like, nobody wants it, you're toxic now, you're radioactive, nobody wants anything to do with you. But no, it's like, no, we're still your friends, even though you murdered several of us, which is, Tony's not a big murdering his friends kind of guy, and I realize he had godlike power for a moment there, but, and also, the whole thing is derivative of secret wars and all this other kind of shit. It's like, so you're derivative, failing on basic story structure, you have no arc, and you're shitting on the character you're supposed to be writing this entire time, and he fucks your character, and then me being interested in Hellcat, this miniseries is another opportunity for her to fail and not sell very well, and then to go, well, this is why we can't do anything with Hellcat. Well, maybe you didn't do the right thing with the right people.
And all the Iron Man loyalists never want to see that character ever fucking again.
Right.
Yeah, now it's like infamous for a huge chunk. So here's
an... And the next time one of those guys get an opportunity to write her, they're going to write her as a bitchy scold like she was in the book. She should have been fucking out drinking with Tony. She should have been the bad influence. That would have been the interesting story.
Way better.
Is that she's trying to get him to party and do stuff, and he's into it because he's like feeling bad. It's like she's the new drug. Like, they could have spent 2 years where...
He's not addicted to morphine. He's addicted to Patsy.
Yeah, that would have been a cool ass arc. But no, because he doesn't care about either one of these characters. He's coming in with an agenda. The agenda is to rip apart a type of person he doesn't like. He never should have been hired in the first place. The problem is that Marvel's woke. The problem is Marvel is star fuckers, and they're going to go get some TV guy to write their character for 2 years instead of somebody who actually cares about the character and understands the character and honestly can write good comics. This is another huge problem I have with the star fucker shit, where you're bringing people from outside media. Writing comics is hard. People have trouble writing things like comic books because they're supposed to be relatively short stories. They have certain formulas. They have certain rhythms. There's a way that things go from panel to panel and page to page and arc to arc. And if you don't understand that, you shouldn't be writing a major publisher's comic book just because you have an IMDb page. Fuck you.
So another, this is like the second page of the very first issue. He talks about how he's doing like an interview with some woman. He wants to get back to his roots. And she says, by roots, you're referring to a $65 billion exit package from Stark Unlimited and a $14.8 million Malibu mansion and a computerized iron suit that's as dangerous as a thermonuclear weapon. He's like, And he goes, I did reinvest a third of that exit package. And she goes, which immediately caused a wild 800-point pendulum swing in the NASDAQ this morning. It's just like...
Everything.
It's fucking everything. It's like...
I don't want a rich guy trying to solve all my problems, too. You can confront that. Fuck Warren Buffett. Fuck Elon Musk. Fuck Steve Jobs. Fuck Microsoft boy. Bill Gates. Fuck Richard Branson. Fuck all these rich guys who think that they're going to run the world and solve all of our problems, and they just fuck shit up worse, or they continue to get all kinds of tax breaks. If Bill Gates is a real humanitarian, why the fuck does his company still have the patent on the fucking COVID vaccine when third world countries had people dying? Is he really that good of a guy? No, he's not. You can confront that, but you can also still have, but Iron Man is trying to do better, or show us why what he does isn't what those guys do, or even show that he is kind of that bad, but he has good traits and he does some good, because ultimately Bill Gates does still do some good. I'm not happy with these guys. I don't think these are the guys who are going to save us. I think these guys perpetuate systems that create enormous wealth inequality and continue to depress underdeveloped nations and all this kind of fucked up shit. You can confront that, but still write a book about a superhero who flies around in armor and beats up bad guys. You can do both. You don't just have to spend 2 years shitting on the very concept when it's your job to address that concept in a way that's going to appease an audience. And like you said, apparently some of these Amazon guys liked it, or they're a bunch of fucking ideologues who know what he did and they're fucking pumping him up because you can write an Amazon review for whatever the fuck you want to, just like you can post a YouTube video for whatever you want to. This world, I hate this world at this point. Like, nobody, just be honest.
Yeah, like, know? I said, I you know, sometimes I do this where people go too far one way. Like, when I saw that dude's video and he's like screaming at the camera about how bad this run was, I'm like, there's no way it was that bad. Like, there's no way. And like I said, in fact, it just made me want to read it more, which is why I picked up that fourth trade. And I was like, now I want to read this. And again, it's very pretty. Okay. But it's just like, it shouldn't have taken an entire second trade for the flight to Galactus' ship. That's the flight to Galactus' ship. And then, you know, I'm sort of like, okay, you know what? This is kind of just bad writing. Like, this is not, like, I understand what's going on. It's not like it's incoherent.
A TV writer writer is capable of writing palatable dialogue. That doesn't mean that you could write a comic book story with the correct beats and running the correct time.
So I thought when I was going into 25 issues, I was getting like multiple stories. I thought I was getting multiple stories. And maybe there's an overarching story that takes place, but like a big bad. But Korvac's like an issue in one. Like they hit the core. There is nothing else going on other than, if you want to call the interaction between Patsy and Tony is another story. It's not, because they're together in the room fighting Korvac, right? This is all going, like if this arms trading story that popped up afterwards was floating in between it. You know what I mean? Like, that's more the storytelling I'm used to, where Korvac, he's getting more powerful in the background while Tony's doing, that's more what I'm used to with traditional comic books. This was the whole thing.
Yeah. And again, Patsy Walker, first issue, is going to be the most important character in this guy's life for the next 2 years, because I said so.
Yeah,
it's not even a Patsy Walker that I recognize. I'm just tired of this. And you wanted me to pay $4 or $5 a month for people to just not to butcher the characters.
Yeah.
And just like, they've got a Power Girl miniseries going on right now. If you know nothing else about Power Girl, she has near Superman level powers. She is a outspoken feminist with a lot of confidence. She's got a mangy cat. Those are the only three things you absolutely have to get right, and everything else you can kind of play with. And they're writing this like insecure character, even using the name. Like, she has a name in the comics. It's Karen or Kara. And they decided, no, she's Paige now. It's like, you're not even using the character's name. You're writing her completely different from any way she's ever been. She's all sad and insecure and a fuck up, and she can't get anything right. And it's like, I'm so sick of these fucking kids coming to write these books, bringing their fucking emotional baggage into it, and basically having a wine fest for 5 or 6 issues. Fucking figure your shit out. You're getting to write a goddamn comic book. Maybe try to be happy about it. Maybe they're not paying you. I'm sorry.
Yeah, but at least
enjoy
true.
The fact that they're producing your fucking comic book. I don't want to read about how sad your goddamn life is. Fuck you. I'm here to enjoy the stories I'm reading. I'm here for escapism. I don't need to hear about, oh, I have imposter syndrome. You can write that story, but maybe don't do it with a character that's known for being confident and brazen and shit, you know? Just fuck off.
Yeah, so I guess to end the podcast, what Iron Man stuff should I read next? Should I go? I never read the extremist stuff. I didn't like the movie.
I mean, the Adi Granov artwork is nice. Yeah, you're not really a Warren Ellis guy. I don't know how much you would like that. Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know. I'm sure that shit's collected, right? I need stuff that's easily collected. I'm not sure I'm vibing on going back to the Dan Slott stuff now, or, you know,
that was the other thing I was going to bring up too. Sad Sack, who tries to do good and it always turns bad on him, is Peter Parker. Go write Peter Parker story. Don't make Tony Stark Peter Parker. Okay, basic shit.
And there was the reason I almost bought the Dan Slott stuff was because, who was this dude doing the covers for Dan Slott stuff?
Shit.
I messaged this guy on Twitter one time because one of these covers, I don't know what issue number this is, but it's not. He's like swimming in a glass of bourbon, and it's amazing. And so I had actually figured out who the artist was, and I messaged him and I was like, please tell me this is a poster somewhere. And the guy's like, I don't think it's ever been reproduced anywhere. Yeah, so this was Tony Stark Volume 2. This is Dan Slott. But unfortunately, these covers were so good, it like, I kind of wanted to get this stuff, but based on just what other people are saying about it, I probably shouldn't do that. So I don't know.
I know that Dan Slott had a really great run on Spider-Man, and a lot of people liked Spider-Man.
Yeah.
And a lot of people hated Spider-Man 2, but he took some big swings, and sometimes it hit and sometimes it didn't. We have Spider-Verse movies because of Dan Slott, okay? That means something. I don't know if that worked as well on Iron Man. I just don't know. I'm not in the Iron Man circles to know that. I know that obviously it didn't hit as hard, but he's still working at Marvel, where a lot of these guys that had like sophomore slump kind of disappeared, and all of a sudden they're at like Dark Horse or DC or some shit. Slott's still working for Marvel, so, you know, as a matter of fact, I think he just had a run on Fantastic Four, and I think that was reasonably well regarded. I think there's another guy writing it now, though.
Yeah, so maybe it's the superior Iron Man stuff, but I feel like that, I don't know how much backstory I'm going to need. Again, what was nice about this was that I kind of just jumped into it.
You ought to try that Kieron Gillen stuff. And also, if I remember correctly, around the time of the first Iron Man movie, Matt Fraction and Sal LaRocca had a run that was well regarded too. Because like, it was funny because it was one of those rare instances of synergy where they got Iron Man right on film. And then when I left Iron Man screening, Bedrock City has a booth where they're selling the new Iron Man comic book by Fraction LaRocca, one of the best artists to work on Iron Man in a while. And apparently one of the best writers as well. And elements from their run also found their way into the MCU. So that might be a good place to start.
Okay. I will look into that. We'll see. And maybe we'll have another, maybe next year or in another decade, we'll do another talk about Iron Man again. Oh my God. All right. Dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun
All right, the only enough sayer this time was Billy Hines, who wrote, "I enjoyed this more than the films being discussed, I think. Thor beats working. Permanent Marvelite Maximus followers include Alan Moe, Audra Pomel, Mark Carson, and Shanwaj Tamboli. Keepers of the Favorite's Flame include Anthony I. U.S. or Us, Artificial Twins, Billis by Vinyl, Chammy Talks Comics, He They, Divinity Rising, Gregory Litchfield, Julia Raul, Kailash, Jwalamukhi, Writer and Media in Charge, Ladies of Mischief Wrestling Fan Page and Gaming, Maxo, Nick Spence, Ock, Rad Adventures Podcasting Network, Relatively Geeky Podcast Network, Speaker of the House Kirk Spencer, Thirsty's New and Used, and Tony S. Endurance Survive. Retweet Frantic Ones, our CH, and talk nerdy to me. And finally, the Merry Marvel Marching Society, Billy Hines, On My Way to Blue Skies, Chris Leiden, Ed Moore, Teal Productions, The Hammer Strikes, Random Geeky Stuff, Derek WC at History of Comics on Film, Iowa's Joe Is, The Irredeemable Shag, JMT Productions, Keith G. Baker, Randy Caldwell, Richard Field, Satin Tides 101 Podcast, and Superbound.
The Marvel Superheroes Podcast is in no way affiliated with or endorsed by Marvel Entertainment. All characters mentioned and audio clips employed are believed covered under fair use, with no infringement intended against their copyright holders. Views expressed in this podcast are assumed legitimate, truthful, and solely possessed by the speaker.
You can lose your power, crush, and keep me trim and in step with the film about that.
With Tony and Iron Man, he's a man who thinks he's a god and a god who wants to be a man. That to me boils down the conflict of the character. I think Tony's ego has always been a major problem for him in his life. And so the book really starts with Tony taking a look at himself. Who am I really? What is Iron Man? I want to be a hero again. What does that mean? Hellcat is someone where the artifice has really dropped on her. And she has this kind of liberation of being herself. And so she can call Tony on his BS, right? She can look at his new humble image and go, I don't think you're really going far enough if you really want to restart and find your humanity. And I think that makes her a great foil for him in this story.